with Sam Seder.
The destiny of America is always safer in the hands of the people than in the conference rooms of any elite.
Sam Seder.
They are unanimous in their hate for me, and I welcome their hatred.
We must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
The Majority Report with Sam Seder.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated?
It is Tuesday, November 3rd, 2020. My name is Sam Seder. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal, the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. It's election day, folks. I hope that's not the first time you're hearing that. On the program today, political correspondent for the Washington Post, Dave Weigel will be here. Also on the program, it's election day. As you know, the stakes include 4 years of a presidency, at least one, if not four, Supreme Court seats, maybe 100 federal judicial seats, control of the Senate, control of state houses, control of redistricting, ability to address climate change, health care, education, the environment, labor issues, a more aggressive response to COVID, and a more humane one to the economic suffering during this pandemic. Probably also infrastructure. We never had that infrastructure week. Meanwhile, Bill Barr preps more federal prison guards for potential election unrest. Deborah Birx, the latest to say Trump's COVID response is off the rails. And despite the fact that we have more absentee ballots this year, mail-ins, their failure rates are lower. All this, and of course, much, 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 much more on today's Majority Report. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. If you are anything like me, you are operating on just minutes of sleep as opposed to hours. Minutes of sleep. Pretty tense out there today. I don't know if you've picked up on that. Hopefully you have either already voted, or you are waiting in line to vote, or you are making plans to vote later today. It's really not a lot of reason to watch this program today if you don't really have an intention to vote. And of course, we have, like I said at the beginning of the show, not just the presidency in the balance, but the Senate. The Supreme Court is already 6-3 in terms of conservatives to left of center folks. But there is an opportunity, hopefully, if the Democrats take control of the Senate, hopefully there is a will to finally reform and expand the court, make it consistent with the number of circuit courts we have in this country, federal circuit courts, and hopefully more long-term reformation of the court too, so that it does not become so political to the extent that it can be depoliticized, or I should say at least de-partisanized, or I should say incapable of being leveraged in the way that it's being leveraged. Let's put it that way. I have seen no election expert or amateur, for that matter, suggest that there is an opportunity for the Democrats to lose control of the House. There is wide belief that the Democrats have a very good chance of winning the Senate. And the ranges on predictions for this election range from a huge blowout for Joe Biden to a squeaker that Donald Trump wins. So there we have it. I would not wager a dollar on whether the election is resolved tonight or within the next couple of weeks. I can tell you that we'll be doing this show today for 12 hours. And no joke, we're also just coincidentally celebrating our 10-year anniversary of this program in its current iteration. Of course, it originally started on Air America back in 2004, just months before the Bush-Kerry election. And I was live that night for the Bush-Kerry election. And I can tell you, being on live radio, as you are anticipating a win for John Kerry in that instance, and it not happening, not fun. But I think on some level, it really doesn't matter where you are going to be. Having Donald Trump serve another 4 years is not fun, is the least of the worries. So we will plow through that. Again, we will keep you updated if we hear anything in terms of anything that's going on around the country. I can tell you that the supposed army of poll watchers that we were led to believe were going to be deployed have yet to materialize. To a certain extent, the majority of ballots, I'd maybe say closer probably to half, half the ballots in this election have already been cast as of 7 a.m. this morning, Eastern Standard Time. So hopefully we will not see as long lines at these ballot places as we tend to see on election day, but we will give you reports as we hear more. We anticipate hearing from Florida tonight. In terms of ballots being counted, in terms of North Carolina, we should have a result. But places like Pennsylvania could take a couple of days. Wisconsin could take a couple of days. Conceivable Michigan, same. And Arizona also possibly could take days. So we just don't know. But my sense is, and we'll talk to Dave Weigel about this, if we hear that Florida has gone for Joe Biden tonight, I think people will be taking some deep breaths, at least people who were interested in Joe Biden winning the election. Donald Trump had some closing arguments. And I think it might be worth... Here is Donald Trump on Monday. He's in Grand Rapids, Michigan. This is clip number 3. And again, he is desperately trying to push the narrative, the talking point, the bizarre belief that the winner of the election is the person who has the most ballots that have been counted as of a certain time, not clear when, on this day, as opposed to counting all the ballots that have been legally cast. It's a novel idea, but why not? Here's Donald Trump pushing that one more time in Grand Rapids.
It was a political decision. I don't know what it was. I don't know what they were thinking. And you know what? Maybe I should, maybe I shouldn't be speaking this way. I'm very disappointed on behalf of this country that a thing like this could happen, because we could be waiting for weeks before we ever find out what's going on. The whole world is waiting for this decision. It's a very sad thing, and hopefully it's going to be changed. Hopefully their wisdom, and they have wisdom, hopefully their wisdom will prevail and they'll do something, and lawyers will be going in and they'll be fighting, and, you know, but people, in fact, it's all over television tonight. I'm coming from place to place, and the good thing about Air Force One, it's got more televisions than any hotel room in the world, okay? You have them on the floors. You have them on the ceilings. You have them all over. And you see the comments that are being made about the decision. And some of the pros are saying, this is a very dangerous decision for our country because so many things, I mean, they're going to say, well, how many votes short are we? We need 6,000 votes. Well, let's take 6,000 of these. We'll put them over here. Let's take 6,000 of these. It's going to be cheating. It's going to be cheating. It's like they're putting these people. And you know what? We don't consider the people that have been running elections in Philadelphia, to be very honest. We've had a lot of problems with Philadelphia. So that's the story, and hopefully that'll be changed. And I'm sure the people would say, oh, you shouldn't speak that way about the Supreme Court. We've had so many bad decisions out of the Supreme Court that I will speak that way, and that's the way it is. This election is also a choice between...
Now, when I hear that, it leads me to believe that he's heard some bad polling about Pennsylvania. Because if he's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, complaining about election officials counting in Philadelphia, it leads me to believe that he is just somebody gave him a brief, right? Like Pennsylvania looks tough.
I'm a little preoccupied at the moment.
I'm
Michigan.
Sorry. I know we're in Grand Rapids. Michigan, Michigan. It's good. Cars. But Philadelphia election officials, right? Like, what is the... We're going to take some ballots from over here, and then we're going to mix them in from over here. I don't know. All right, let's play one more clip of Donald Trump's final message to the country. It is his last campaign video. It is him dancing to YMCA, which, of course, was a huge cruising icon song back in the 70s, back when things like, you know, Christopher Street was – the people wearing chaps and stuff like that. And here's Donald Trump singing it. Now, of course, we can't play it because of rights reasons. So we're just going to watch Donald Trump dance without any sound. There he is. He's making the moves that really, wow. It's quite a closing argument.
With my hands.
I did. What is with that? Is that just sort of a way to sort of... He can't move his
He's
legs.
He's just embraced it, I think. I think this is a side effect of steroids.
Do you think this is a medical problem? Or do you think he's just like nervous about moving his legs in front of people?
I think you're just jealous because you can't do it yourself.
You know, I have to say, and also what creeps me out about this video is there's that video of him with Jeffrey Epstein, and he's sort of doing the same sort of dancing moves there. So at least we know it's sincere.
Definitely the same mood.
Yes. And he's not actually doing the Y's or the MCAs. But somebody must have told him, like, people really like it when they see you use the pom-pom move when you dance. All right. I don't think I need to see any more of that. I hope it's the last I ever see, frankly. All right. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Dave Weigel from the Washington Post to hear his closing remarks, I guess, before the election. Hey, folks, today's program, all 12 hours of it, sponsored by Sunset Lake CBD. They have an Election Day sale running right now. It's 25% off two new strains of hemp flower they grew this year. You got to use promo code VOTE25 for this special 25% off these strains. There's Server, which have an 18.9% CBD. Apparently, it's the most potent hemp flower strain they have ever grown. They've taken great care to preserve the aroma and the potency that makes this strain stand out from the rest of the pack. And they also have a sour special sauce. Matt, isn't that the one that you like?
The special sauce is pretty good. I like all the brands, to be honest. I'm not a huge differentiator of the flavors.
Okay. Well, the sour special sauce is 16.6 CBD. It's one of the rarest flower strains on the market. The aroma of the flower, fiercely distinct from other strains, its earthy tones harken back to the rich New England soil that nourished this plant. So listen, it's vote 25 for 25% off of these strains. However, Sunset Lake CBD has been sponsoring this program for some time now. And if you use their code LEFTISBEST, one word, LEFTISBEST, you get 20% off all their other products. It's great CBD. We're going to be talking about it more over the course of today. They have sponsored the whole program today, 12 hours. And I just want to say thank you to Free Range Wine and Spirits. As the day progresses, we're all going to be drinking a little bit.
Shout out. I got mine yesterday.
Matt got his, Brendan, Jamie, and Emma's going to be joining us this afternoon. She got some liquor. So we've all got, I'll be talking more about what we're drinking later, but it's Free Range Wine and Spirits. They have been fans of this program since the Air America days. Jack Chester, who is the proprietor, rock critic turned wine blogger. And you could check out, they got great selections, and it's right down here on Atlantic Avenue in scenic Borum Hill, Brooklyn. FreeRangeBrooklyn.com, you can find out. And if you use the coupon code MAJORITY at checkout, you get 10% off your first purchase at FreeRangeBrooklyn.com. Thank you, guys. Between CBD and the booze, that is going to be the way that I get through this day. It's been quite an era. All right. Joining us now, do we have him, is Dave Weigel. He is the political correspondent for the Washington Post newspaper. He is also the proprietor, the writer, I don't know exactly, of the trailer. Mm-hmm. How do you refer to that? The newsletter? What is it, Dave?
I say newsletter. That's still what people like. It's still a newsletter if it's not on Substack, right? Did they buy the proprietary name?
That's a good question. Let's hope that we have such things to ruminate on after today. All right. So wait a second. So we spoke to about a week or two ago. Mm-hmm. Broadly speaking, what is the dynamics of the race? I mean, I kept waiting for another shoe to fall. But right. It feels like there has not been any change in the dynamic of the race really in the past 3 or 4 weeks. I mean, we can talk about Hunter Biden. There was quite a piece in the Daily Caller today where mm-hmm. they did a deep dive, and really all they found was that at various times, Joe Biden offered like his son like $150 so that he had gas money. I mean, honestly, there's something sort of a little bit sad, but also a little bit cute about it in some way, but it doesn't reek of major corrupt, money flowing from Hunter Biden to Joe Biden, but nothing seems to have changed the dynamic.
Yeah. It's very different than the final 2 weeks of 2016, which I mean, people, I think, have a pretty vivid memory of. Hillary Clinton was ahead, but well under 50%. And the Comey letter hurt her. Republicans said it, and I'm kind of obsessed with this, because if you go back to the reporting from the day of the letter and the day after, Republicans were admitting, hey, this puts us back in the game that we might have been out of had he not done this. In retrospect, that's kind of been minimized. Well, we were going to win anyway. They were not on a trajectory to win without that. And so the Hunter Biden thing is a great comparison. It drops further, it's actually more days between that and the election by I think 2 days, honestly, than the Comey letter. No evidence that it was moving any of Joe Biden's numbers. Now, did it move some people who might have been on the fence? Not really evidence of that either. I was pointing out earlier today that if you look at the candidates' favorable numbers, Hillary Clinton, who was viewed unfavorably before the Comey letter, took a hit. Really, her advantage over Trump on who was viewed more favorably fell by half, and it picked up a little bit closer to the election. Where with Joe Biden, there's been no movement whatsoever from the Comey letter, from anything else kind of thrown at him in the final 2 weeks of this campaign, not the second debate. Nothing has caused him to break away in ways that he wasn't. And so you've seen some state polling that's been a little better for him. Some that's been a little worse. Nothing that's shown him expanding his lead over a month ago, right? And it might be the case that the aftermath of the first debate, Trump getting COVID, even though Trump didn't really come up with a coherent message after that, that was him bottoming out and that he's settled in around 44-45%. That's, you know, Michael Dukakis territory in terms of the popular vote, and nothing. It's really the Hunter Comey split screen, the side by side of how they affected the race is really telling, you know, as much as anything that's coming out of state polls.
I don't want to dwell too much on what you know, Trump failed to do in terms of running against Joe Biden, and maybe this is something that is more apropos for after the election, because we don't know. But if Donald Trump's best shot at winning, at least, you know, changing the dynamic of this race, right, where, you know, Donald Trump has in many respects a ceiling. If he wins, it's going to be because, it seems to me, he was able to target very narrowly some states, and by him, I mean his campaign, and they were able, between a combination of suppression and voting hijinks and, you know, court cases, maybe they could squeak something out. But in terms of just a sheer campaign, it seems to me that Trump needed to depress Joe Biden's vote, right? Because he didn't have an opportunity to expand that much as it was. Mm-hmm. And the one thing that could have depressed the vote, it seems to me, would have been, and I don't know if it would have been successful, but Joe Biden, before he was Obama's vice president, was not a particular darling of the of a big segment of the Democratic Party, right? I mean, he was very closely associated with the banks and the credit card companies. The bankruptcy bill is literally what pulled Elizabeth Warren into politics. And Joe Biden's bankruptcy bill stuff was Elizabeth Warren's origin story in some ways as a politician. And none of that was exploited at all by Donald Trump.
It wasn't. And I mean, if you go back, I recommend, if you want to read Trump speeches today, there's a site, Rev, you know, rev.com. That captures transcripts, puts them online. You know, the Post has its own thing, but I like the open source version of this. And his messaging on the trail is very confusing. And not to bring everything back to Comey in the final stage of the last campaign, but Trump had a message that wound together pretty well, which was that Hillary Clinton is corrupt. Look at all the stuff coming out about her that says she's corrupt. And part of that corruption is being responsible for everything bad that's happened. From our global trade deals, from just corruption in Washington writ large, everything's related to her. She's been there and she hasn't fixed it. With Biden, he was trying to come up with something similar and never really settled on it. There was a week maybe where the argument was going to be that Biden was so doddering that Kamala Harris was the real presidential nominee, but they didn't really do anything to make her a kind of figure of hate among Republican voters. And not to reduce everything to who people hate more, but I remember I was talking to a Democrat in Ohio who'd been a congressman, lost in the 2010 wave, and was still involved in politics. And he was saying, look, I see some Joe Biden signs in Eastern Ohio, not like a ton, you know, not what I would have seen 20 years ago, but when I drove around here in 2016, all I saw that said Hillary on them were Hillary for prison signs, you know, homemade, InfoWars stickers, things like that. And Biden just did not animate the right in the same way. And Trump, you could see, I mean, if he loses this, he wasted so much time just trying to recreate 2016 with different ingredients. He even a lot, and you were mentioning the left was not happy about how the primary went, but no one seriously argued that it was unfair. I mean, the most people say is that it wasn't cool, I guess, for two moderate candidates to drop out right before Super Tuesday and swing their votes to Biden. He might have won without that. Maybe Elizabeth Warren should have dropped out sooner. But it's not the same thing as we have emails from inside the DNC about people unhappy about Sanders. I mean, the deal on superdelegates, which prevented them from voting on the nomination really at all at the DNC, that did its part. And so you didn't have a left that felt like it was unfair. Now, did they like Biden? Did they think he was going to provide change? No, they didn't. But there's not the same animus that you get if you feel that somebody took the election from you unfairly. And you can kind of see Twitter is not real life. You see some of this attitude on Twitter that when Hunter Biden's emails come out, the most common reaction I see on the left is kind of high-fiving virtually and people joking that Hunter Biden looks cool. But Trump never adjusted to this. I mean, Trump even wasted time in the first debate just repeating how Biden was going to lose the left because of the positions he was taking. I mean, so he both expected Biden to be kind of in hock to the left in ways that he's very comfortable not being. He loves pointing out that he's not going to ban fracking. He loves pointing out that he beat Bernie Sanders. And he also expected the left to be angry at Biden for the reasons you just mentioned. I'm going to stay this one out. No evidence of that. I mean, there's really no evidence that are there some people who voted green last time are going to vote green this time, who are going to write in somebody this time? That's totally going to happen, but there's no evidence it's going to be even a fifth of what it was before. And in polling third-party voters, and a lot of those people were angry about this 2016 primary, third-party voters are breaking into Biden 2-1. So why didn't Donald Trump adjust to that? I have no idea. I think he just watches a lot of TV, and TV told him that it would work.
Yeah, I think what's clear is that Hillary Clinton, almost everybody that Donald Trump gets his advice from or watches had essentially built their careers on demonizing the Clintons. Yeah. And so they had a narrative that worked. None of these people had really anything cohesive to say about Biden. Like I say, the best critiques of Biden come from the left, it seems to me. And they were never deployed because, you know, it's not, Sean Hannity is not used to talking about like credit card companies and bankruptcy bill. And so Donald Trump didn't know about it. And you did get this sort of like incoherent, he's sleepy, but he's also, you know, a mastermind. He is screwing the left, but he's also controlled by them. Like everything contradicted itself from week to week. So the big issue, it seems to me, and one of the things too that was an issue in 2016 is turnout. And that was the last piece you wrote for the trailer. And you chose to follow Ilhan Omar over the course of that, right? Why?
Well, I generally like to zig when everyone else is zagging. And I felt like I remember talking to the Omar people about this, is that like I don't think the world needed another dispatch from Trump country about how the people who voted for Trump still love Trump. We know that already. But a part of this election, and this is kind of dovetailing what we were talking about before, a big part of this election is, do traditional Democratic areas and newer Democratic areas, cities that have gone from strongly to just overwhelmingly blue, do they get excited for Biden, somebody that, you know, people are less excited for than they were for Barack Obama, objectively? And it's comparable, I think, more to 2012 than it was to either 2008, when people were really excited, or 2016, where they were just kind of grinding it out. And so I want to see one, how she actually turned the vote out, which was she continued to do door to door canvassing and did it for down ballot candidates, even when the Biden campaign spent a few months not doing that. I mean, they transitioned to virtually very end of the campaign. The Biden campaign has been going door to door, but much less than they used to. So she kept that going. And she also, as somebody who did not endorse Biden, didn't even really officially endorse him after he won the nomination, she was very adamant. And she was going to these Somali communities, some suburbs, kind of all over the Minneapolis area and the suburbs, and making a case for removing Trump without being too negative against Biden. And she didn't have to in some cases. I mean, I was with Omar in this one block of affordable condos in Hopkins. And she met two voters who had not voted in 2016 and were voting, had already voted, I should say, for Biden. She met a guy that I quoted and I also took a video of, who was so excited to see her that he ran over and hugged her and chucked his apple like a football. I'm not sure why he did that. But he just kept talking about how great it was that she pissed off Trump and that they were going to elect Biden. I was looking for how much enthusiasm is there, because these states, each of these state races is a war between Democratic turnout and Republican turnout. That's not new. The Trump strategy is based on a Trump strategy, I say, not just for winning, but for defying all the polls, is to find all these people who like him but didn't turn out last time to really show the media. We're going to see this huge rural surge. The other side of that, well,
rural is, surge. I just want to make it clear, because this really surge, is in many respects a fight between finding new voters in the rural areas and finding new voters, or I should say, previously unmotivated voters in the mm-hmm. Urban and rural areas.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's evidence they did that, right? It sounds, and people lived through this in 2004. There was a lot of Democratic wishful thinking. Oh, who could possibly vote for Bush in 2004 who didn't vote for him in 2000, which was a little silly. I mean, 9/11 happened, the Iraq War happened. There was a rallying effect around Bush that faded only after the 2004 election. The difference with Trump is he's never done anything to reach out to the other side. The most he's done is this occasional outreach to Black voters, which is includes, you know, making stuff up about Joe Biden, meeting with rappers. But in terms of winning over people who were skeptical, he's done a terrible job. I mean, he's unpopular. People don't think he's done a good job handling coronavirus. So it seems weird to liberals that there are going to be people who, you know, they never really vote. Maybe they don't, like, honestly, they don't vote because they don't want to get on the list for jury duty. And the Trump campaign spent 3 years finding people and turning them out. That's what they're doing right now. But with Democrats, it's a little harder to spot because they want, the thing you can see is how big turnout is in cities. And it's, you know, it's trending higher in Detroit, trending higher in Minneapolis and Milwaukee. You're not seeing the same fall off that you did in 2016. And you can check this earlier because the early voting, right? That's part of it. The other part that's a little more invisible is who is voting, who is showing up and they're registered Republican or independent and not voting for Trump.
Right.
There's a bit more of that than there was in 2016, according to all the polling. And the danger in a day like this is piling yourself up with anecdotes where you can definitely find Republicans who never voted for a Democrat before and voted for Biden. You can definitely find people who, and I met some when I was in Minnesota, Republicans who say, you know, I voted last time, but I convinced two people who didn't vote for the last few years to vote for Trump. That's going to happen. It's the attrition is going to be there. There's no way that Trump loses by, let's say, like a Herbert Hoover margin, maybe even the Jimmy Carter margin is out of bounds. So some of that happened, but just Democrats have done a very good job in weird conditions finding their voters.
The dynamic, just to be clear, and there have been reports in some states. I don't know if Minnesota was one of them, but some of the formerly blue firewall and from Biden's perspective, hopefully future blue firewall states, that Republican registration was up relative mm-hmm. to Democratic registration. Now, I spoke to Aaron Kleinman the other day, who suggested some of that could very well be just people who have been voting Republican and switched their registration finally in this year. But it's hard to know. But the dynamic that we're looking at is how much can the Democrats run up the vote in the cities to stave off what's happening in the rest of the state? I mean, that's the story of Pennsylvania in many respects, isn't it?
It is, although maybe less than it was before. So I did the series for the trailer that's you can read online, breaking down each state's region and how they moved. And the thing about the blue wall, quote unquote, states is that Hillary Clinton did so bad in so many places that if you just turn the dial a little bit, then she went narrowly. So she lost you'd rather win like Barack Obama in 2012, right? 5 points in Pennsylvania, 10 points in Michigan, 8 points in Wisconsin. Winning by 1 point is going to make is in a year like this with a lot of litigation would make people sweat. But you look at how badly she did everywhere, except for some of the cities. And let's focus on Pennsylvania because he mentioned it. So she actually held Philadelphia turnout about to the levels of 2012. It's often like remembered that people didn't turn out. They did. Trump did a little bit better in Northeast Philly, where there's more kind of white suburbanites. The city did turn out. The Black turnout was not down by that much. She did a little bit better in the suburbs, but not as well as she needed to. She did better in Allegheny County. She got destroyed everywhere else. I mean, she did worse than Democrats had in some cases ever in parts of Pennsylvania. And I was just talking to a Democratic friend there last night. So if you just showed somebody a map of everything in Pennsylvania west of Delaware County, the one of the suburbs, you'd assume she lost by like 10 points because she did so badly in the western Pennsylvania. She did so badly. She lost Erie County, which Democrats never lose. She lost these sections of Northeast Pennsylvania. And you had in 2018, every Democrat on the ballot was able to win that stuff back. And Biden has been more resilient than other Democrats. And every poll, even polls where he's only, and this is where liberals' heads, I think, have gotten because of 2016. They'll look at a poll that shows Biden up 5 and they worry because Hillary had polls that were, she was up 5. She definitely did. But this is polling that now has corrected for education. It factors in the movement to Trump in central Pennsylvania. And it just, Biden is doing better than her in Northeast Pennsylvania and the Philadelphia suburbs. And it's really, if Philadelphia turnout just hits 2016 levels, there is no way for Trump to regain that. Unless he finds 200,000 voters. And you pointed out the registration gains they made. That is a real thing. I mean, there are places where Democrats have been winning, but they did not gain registration. And it's how do you separate that from the reality of this year where they just weren't going out and registering people? They couldn't. I mean, they were at home. They weren't canvassing at all. How much of that is just the Republican advantage from doing that and actually finding people? How much of it is these pro-life Democrats in places like Westmoreland County and Washington County who have been, look, they've been voting Democratic down the ballot for county commissioner through now. They still vote for Democrats. How much of that was people leaving the party? If that's the case, you wouldn't see much movement. And for example, look at West Virginia this year, and West Virginia has a lot in common with Western Pennsylvania. They touch the coal industry, et cetera. West Virginia, if polling is correct, is going to vote for Trump by a little bit less than it did 4 years ago. Now he won by 40 points. Maybe he wins by 30. In that same period, Republicans have utterly erased this long Democratic registration advantage that they had. So people have, it's not like people were just converting to become Trump Republicans. They already were. They were Trump Democrats and they flipped a switch. So we're not sure how many of these registrants are people who never were off the sidelines and how many were just Republicans who didn't make it official. Same thing in Florida. And look, it's not in the Republican Party's interest to say, yeah, we got like 10 guys who voted for Trump last time, and then we found 5 new guys. It's their interest to say we found 15 new Republican voters.
Right. So just getting back to that 2016 thing, I feel like we're, this is like Donald Trump's fantasy that we're replaying 2016 again. But the just in terms to give us insight this time around, so Clinton did she hit all the requisite watersheds, mm-hmm. In terms of, like you say, into the city and some of the suburbs and whatnot. The places that she did really bad, I mean, characterize those locations for us geographically. Give us a sense of like what the demographics are, because, you know, is it, I mean, how much of this is, it's just odd to me that you wouldn't see that it would be so specific in terms of where, because generally, like if you're going to lose an election, right, you sort of lose it across the board, as mm-hmm. opposed to, you know, if I look at these set of stats, it looks like they won. If I look at those set of stats, it looks like they got crushed. Mm-hmm. I mean, what was that disparity?
I mean, it's pretty massive, and it's actually something I think about when we're contemplating what, let's say Trump loses, what people in his base think happened, because the president has campaigned as if, not just as if he is going to win, but as that he's about to win, and the only thing that would stop it is fraud. And what I think compels some of that is, and this is very one-sided, a lot of Trump voters live in places where not only have they been trending Republican for years, but there's more visible support for Trump than there was 4 years ago. Are they from new voters? Mostly they're not. I mean, there's people who last time had a Trump flag, a sign, or maybe were a little bit ashamed, but they voted for him, and now they've got a Trump flag outside their house. But as far as they can tell, there is no world in which Joe Biden can win this. And they look at the rallies on TV. It's been explained many times that Biden is just not having giant in-person rallies because of COVID, because he's basically adhering to whatever the strictest version of local rules is, right? But if you read MAGA Twitter, if you listen to the president, who's making fun of how small the crowds for these candidates are, I mean, he points out that these events that are mostly about getting people on TV, getting the candidates in there, getting people excited, a few people excited locally, that there are a few people at them. So in Trump world and among Trump voters, they tell pollsters they think he's going to win. Whereas Democrats, I think, if they're paranoid after 2016, but they're also paranoid because they know what their neighborhood votes like. They know how much support there is for Joe Biden there. But every time they head into a strongly Republican area, they see so much Trump signs, they figure I'm elite, I'm aloof, I'm out of it. There must be this huge groundswell of support for him. And it is. I mean, I can see in some places, I imagine Trump will get more votes than he got four years ago. More raw votes, certainly, maybe even some bigger margins in parts like some parts of the Florida Panhandle, some parts of rural Wisconsin, and then at the same time lose because he lost more votes elsewhere and just not believe it.
That, I mean, you know, I guess if we look at all the trends, right, like the trend of very disparate media universes that are even less transmuted, and they're also sort of like they're highly siloed, and the walls of those silos are pretty thick. I think certainly in the right wing universe, there's a lot less sort of diversity of thought than there is from, like, you know, I think the center to the left tend to at least be aware of the different media, and that could be an interesting dynamic, is to see how people react. The level of dissonance, I mean, I remember 2004, and it was shocking. We all believe there's no way that George Bush could win this election, because of course he had lost the last one by 500,000 votes and hadn't won it. And he ended up winning by several million votes. I think that type of dynamic is going to be very, very dramatic in some places. And it will be interesting to see how they respond. And then the weird part about it too, is that this is not going to be a Jimmy Carter situation if Trump loses. It's not going to be a Michael Dukakis situation if he loses by, I mean, he's not going to go anywhere, right? Like, there's no reason to believe that he's not going to have another rally Friday.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, that's a different question, because I spent a little time in Iowa in the last week with Tom Cotton and Donald Trump Jr. And then Ted Cruz got there right after I left. And there are Republicans already talking with different language about the party's future. But there's no assumption, like there was in 2016, that if Trump loses, then he'll go away and they can write like a new version of the Republican Party without him. I mean, he's going to remain for the Republican base, the most popular person in the party. And the X factor is how many people end this saying, I bet he won. I bet it was stolen from him. I mean, he said that after 2016. He said that the popular vote was stolen from him. His voters believe that. So it's up to him how much control.
Paul Ryan, at the very least, came pretty close to saying the same thing.
Yeah, no, it's become kind of a catechism. And look, even this is like we're just gathering story, any case of anecdote from Election Day. But I've struck in this political roundtable with Republican strategists, you still have mainstream Republican strategists saying stuff like, well, if you take out the four biggest counties, then Trump will win the popular vote. As you know, just like, let's erase the places that don't vote for us. So I don't think you'll have a sense that, well, this election banishes anything. And Carter's a weird situation. George H.W. Bush, both of them ended their presidencies with a lot of problems with the party's base. Both had primary challengers who kind of went the distance, and Ted Kennedy and Pat Buchanan. So there was a fight over what the party was standing for before they lost. And I mean, Trump's definitely not going to be like Carter. Carter conceded the election when he had lost it before everything was closed on the West Coast, and it made Democrats pissed off forever, convincing people that it was such a rout they should stay home. I don't think you're going to see that from the president.
All right. So, you had written a piece a couple of weeks ago about some state races. Give us a sense of, like, what other races do you think, maybe we can go down from the right. Senate. I mean, there seems to be widespread belief that the Democrats will pick up the Senate, or at least it'll be pretty close. Like, what is your sense on that? But also, are there specific races you think we should be watching?
In terms of timing, I think North Carolina and Arizona, well, North Carolina starts counting votes at 7:30, and it already tabulated stuff that came in before Election Day. North Carolina is going to be pretty telling pretty early, because you had there, frankly, had the same thing in Colorado, different scale. Both Democrat nominees had some sort of scandal that made people worry. And in Colorado, it was this Republican effort to nail John Hickenlooper on some travel he'd taken when he was governor, succeeded, and he had to pay this giant fine. In North Carolina, it's this, you know, the historically sexy scandal where Cal Cunningham was admitted to have had an affair, so he was exposed. And you saw him never lose his lead in polls. You saw his favorable numbers drop, but the dynamics there were already pretty rough for Tom Tillis, the senator who actually lost, you know, he almost lost the race in 2014. He was one of the people forget, because it was everything went broke Republicans' way, but that was kind of a last minute break toward Tillis. And you also have in that race a Libertarian candidate, where if there are people who show up and they're frustrated with having to vote for a guy who had a sex scandal, they can vote for the Libertarian. But in that race, if the Democrat wins, and if he's heading to a win pretty quickly, that will suggest that polling was correct. And if polling is correct there, then we'll know a lot. And we'll you can look at the rest of the map. If it's a Tillis win, polling is wrong. If it's a big Cunningham win, now again, his situation was so strange, but that probably points to the races the Democrats were a little bit nervous about closing, the one, the Georgia's races, Montana, Iowa, that they're probably still in the hunt there. There was some kind of break where suburban voters were so adamant about opposing Republicans this year that they're gonna you know, vote for Biden at the top of the ticket and stay blue on the way down. So because I've watched North Carolina.
Iowa, like Joni Ernst looks like she's doing a little bit better. Like I've noticed the pollsters have taken her from a sort of a toss up to a lean Republican. But you're suggesting, as people watch tonight, if Cal Cunningham wins big against Tom Tillis, and what does big mean? Like
big would be like 6 points or so. I mean, he's had in the final couple of weeks, he's been ahead in every poll, but by single digits and under 50%. Generally, an incumbent who's way under 50% and trailing somebody, it's rare that those guys win, right? I mean, every race that was breaking that direction in 2016 went the other way. So I think that, and because they've got a system where they're going to count fairly quickly, I'd say we'll be able to look at North Carolina, look at the vote patterns from the suburbs, look at actually rural counties where Mike Pence was being sent in the final couple weeks to gin up the vote. We'll see if that worked. It's possible it did. Democrats feel pretty good about that race. I mean, they really think, you know, had Cunningham not gotten into that scandal, that he'd probably be walking away with it. And so, yeah, there'll be a lot of anger at him if it turns out that he lost it. They don't think there's any, looking at the rest of the ticket in the state, they don't think there's any reason. But Tillis, and this is the thing, but all these Senate races have been, they've gotten a little bit less coverage, I think, because of who Trump is and how he dominates the news. They've all been very similar, where every Republican has been utterly unable to explain coherently what they want to do on healthcare. And month after month, come up with, I support some piece of legislation that if the ACA is overturned would protect previous conditions. Although experts say with every Senate race, Democrats have just been entirely focused on healthcare and COVID, like Biden. I mean, they've all been running this kind of unified campaign along the lines Biden's running.
Is that the same in House races too? Is it all been
mostly? Yeah, mostly in the House races too. I mean, the only difference is when there's a scandal that breaks out. So the Cunningham race would also say, is the Democratic message of Trump screwed everything up powerful enough to take down a senator who didn't have a scandal with a challenger who did? And that's why I think that race will be interesting really quickly.
It'll be fascinating to see if the Democrats do take the Senate and Joe Biden wins and they build their lead in the House. If healthcare is actually one of the early things that they address, because it certainly seems to me that it was also sort of the hallmark of the 2018 victory was all around healthcare. And at one point you got to deliver. So, all right. So we're going to look to North Carolina. If Cunningham's up over 6 points, then that bodes very well for some of the other Senate races across the country. What else? What else should we be looking at? Tell me your top five counties or four counties that you look at. I know all you guys have your favorite. Counties.
I joke about Waukesha County, Wisconsin, but not really, because that is kind of the essential northern white flight county, right? That is outside Milwaukee, a huge suburban area where Republicans dominate, where they tend to they pull a margin of like 80,000 votes out of the county in a good year. And it over, if they're winning, it overwhelms what Democrats got out of their regions. I always joke about county. I think it's worth watching to see if the president is only winning it by like 60,000 votes, he's probably losing definitively across Wisconsin.
Okay.
I'd say Pinellas, Florida, Pinellas is like St. Petersburg and Clearwater. In that place, you have in 2016, you had Hillary Clinton win the early vote, but not by a ton. And then Trump voters on Election Day overwhelming it. So they carry the county. Pinellas should go Democratic if they're winning statewide. So watch there. And okay. Florida's gonna be complicated because there's gonna be some crossover independents in parts of the state and some crossover Cuban Americans voting in Miami-Dade who have voted. They voted for Romney and they didn't vote for Trump, and now they're voting for Trump again. So that complicates some of the Democrats' math. So those two in the big states. I think Erie County, Pennsylvania, which will take a while. I mean, they're allowed to start processing ballots, but Erie is the key place where Biden campaigned there twice, actually, where Hillary Clinton never did. It's the sort of thing that if traditional Democrats are coming home, they should win. In addition to that, I mean, I'm thinking Dubuque County, Iowa, similar story. Democrats should be winning that if they're even losing by 4 points statewide. And if they're winning Dubuque, that means a lot of the Trump coalition, a lot of the country has fallen apart. And then Maricopa County, Arizona, that's basically the election in Arizona. Maricopa County counts fast. It does. Ballots that arrive today will be counted over the next few days, as we remember from the Senate race last time. But if there's a pretty decisive lead for Biden in Maricopa on election night, there's a chance that the race gets called.
Wow. Okay.
All right. That race gets called.
Yeah. Now, of course, if he wins in Florida too, right? I mean, that's.
Yeah.
If Biden wins in Florida, which is possible that it could be called by 10:30, 11. Mm-hmm. Possible, right? I mean,
it's possible because there would be some absentee voting coming in. There'd be some military voting coming in. But if it was a margin of say 3 points, that's not going to be overwhelmed by what comes in later. So that's possible. And so, The final, I've been making fun of some people on Twitter for the 11th hour panic. You have, on the one hand, people getting angry that Biden is going to Georgia and Florida instead of focusing on the Midwest, and then being angry again when Biden goes to the Midwest on the theory that he's only going there because he's losing. The campaign's very clear on this. The Biden campaign think they're winning, but because the president keeps talking about challenging votes after Election Day, they want to have such an advantage clearly on election night. It could be a state getting called is their idea. Like you just put it out there. If Democrats have won Florida tonight, then there is no path for Trump to win with any combination of states after that. So that's their dream is winning a Florida, frankly, winning a state like Georgia on election night. Also there's no, people will tell you there's no Trump map that works without Georgia. So they want like a kill shot early on. And then the rest, they want to win, but they're operating on the principle that some of the states they think he'll win, like Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, might take longer. And Wisconsin probably is not going to be callable until 4 a.m. or so. So that's their dream, is people go to bed thinking, at the very least, Biden has an advantage and Trump can't win.
Dave, I'm not going to lie. That's my dream. Florida and Arizona called, you know, before midnight. That is my dream. But you know, you can't always get what you want.
Yeah.
But Dave, thank you so much. Folks can check out the trailer. This has been great stuff. And, hopefully next time we talk, it won't be specifically about the outcome, the outcome of this election will have been resolved. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, there's a lot more that will happen after this election. Once we're done the new chaotic stuff, the actual governing agenda, we can talk about that.
Indeed, or maybe the runoffs in Georgia Senate race. We'll see if that's going to happen. Dave Weigel, The Washington Post, thanks so much for your time.
All right, thank you.
All right, folks, going to take a quick break. Back in just a moment, we will hear Joe Biden's closing message. We'll be right back. So here it is, folks. It is election day, and here is Joe Biden's closing argument. It was in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Of course, is really in many respects a must win, insofar as I mean, if Joe Biden wins Florida, there's reason to believe he's going to win Pennsylvania. There's reason he's going to believe he could possibly win Georgia even, but Michigan and Wisconsin. But Pennsylvania, in many respects, is sort of the firewall. And here he is in Pittsburgh with his closing message.
We've been through a lot in this country since we announced. America's facing a confluence of crises unlike anything in living memory. We're still in the battle for the soul of America. Decency, honor, respect. Where has it gone with this president? But let me tell you something, folks. Tomorrow's the beginning of a new day. Tomorrow, we can put an end to a presidency that has left hardworking Americans out in the cold. Tomorrow, we can put an end to a presidency that has divided this nation and fanned the flames of hate. Tomorrow, we can put an end to a presidency that has failed to protect this nation. Ladies and gentlemen, millions of Americans have already voted, close to 100 million, and millions more will vote tomorrow. And my message to you is simple. The power to change this country is in your hands. In your hands. I don't care how hard Donald Trump tries. There's nothing that's going to stop the people of this nation from voting. Period. And when America votes, America will be heard. And America's heard. I believe the message will be loud and clear. It's time for Donald Trump to pack his bags and go home. I honest to God believe the vast majority of Americans are done with the chaos, the corruption, the failure, the irresponsibility, the indifference to American lives, the indifference to America's dignity. We've got a lot of work to do. Not division and distraction, but real, real, real healing of this country. If you elect me your president, I'm going to heal this country, and we're going to act. We're going to act to get COVID under control beginning on day one.
I mean, what's interesting about that is that he doesn't. I don't disagree with anything he said about Donald Trump. And the only thing I don't appreciate is I don't want him back in New York, frankly. I don't even think we should pack him, send him back home. I think maybe a garbage scow off the coast of, off the East Coast somewhere.
Changed his residency.
Yeah. Can't we? But none of that was an affirmative. None of that was an affirmative pitch.
That was the Biden campaign right there.
Exactly. I mean, it's a complete summary of the Biden campaign in that regard. None of it was an affirmative pitch. I mean, look, it. We will know more in 10 hours, 12 hours, or 36 hours. But he certainly it was an effective run on his part to make it just about a referendum on Donald Trump. And he did that. He was effective in that regard. That is our. So we weren't even streaming on MSNBC on channel today, were we, Brendan?
I learned at some point this morning that was the case.
All right. Well, then that's fine. Well, then we have the ability to make a big announcement. This is what we're going to do, folks. We're going to take a. We're going to take a little bit of break and head into the fun half. But in fact, it's the fun half is going to be open to everybody. And the fun half is going to consist of 11 more hours of broadcasting today. I feel like I'm just like, this is, I'm ready to do, I feel like I could do it 11 and a half hours. And not only are we covering the election, we are also celebrating the 10-year anniversary of this program. And not only that, it's because we really want to, like, you know, get all of these milestones and events out of the way at once. We're introducing the newest member of our team. We've already, I mean, people already know, but we're going to, she's going to, and she's been here before, but it's still going to be pretty dramatic. And it's the first time I have been in studio with anybody for 7-8 months or something, whatever, since March. I have constructed a very sort of haphazard looking, but protective gear. We will talk about that when we return. Just a reminder, it's your support that makes this show possible. It has been your support that has made this show possible for 10 years. For 10 years. I can't believe it. To the day we've been doing this show. And really, obviously impossible to have done it without the support of our members. There's a couple of other specific individuals who I will mention over the course of the day that it would not have been possible had they, I don't know, decided to do something else with their lives or hadn't gone to one event or seen me, you know, for lunch one day and that never happened. The show would not have happened. But we will be talking to them throughout the day as well. We're going to be folks that we're going to be hearing from today range from Andy Kindler all the way to David Feldman. There's more than people than that, but sort of the narrowest subset of people that we could have. But we get a bunch of people, and we're going to be taking phone calls. We're going to hear from John from San Antonio. We're going to shadow ban Ronald Reagan. We're going to hear from Janine Garofalo, hoping is going to call in at one point. So stick around with us. It should be fun. And we've got a lot of clips and I don't know. We'll see. But again, if you want to become a member, support the show, great day to do it. I know if I was better at the business, I would have made this like a big like subscriber push and we would have graphics and ads and stuff like that. But I'm sorry, just too much to just involve too much crap. So there it is. Don't forget justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. They have been with us for 10 years as well. On day one, I think I was they were sponsoring the show. Or pretty close to it. I probably couldn't get my act together on day one. All right, we're going to take a quick break and we'll come back and keep the show going. Nobody's going anywhere. We'll be right back after this.
Left is best.
Jamie and I may have a disagreement.
Yeah, you can't just say whatever you want about people just because you're rich.
I have an absolute right to mock them on YouTube.
He's up there buggy whipping like he's the boss.
I am not your employer.
You know, I'm tired of the negativity.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to upset you. You're nervous, you're a little bit upset, you're riled up.
Yeah, maybe you should rethink your defense of that, you fucking idiots.
We're just going to get rid of you.
All right.
But dude. You want to smoke this joint?
Yes.
Do you feel like you are a dinosaur?
Some good shit.
Exactly. I'm happy now.
It's a win-win.
It's a win-win-win.
Oh, hell yeah.
Now listen to me. 2, 3, 4, 5 times. 847-906-501-457. 2, 38, 56, 27. 1/2, 5/8. 3.9 billion.
Wow.
He's the ultimate math nerd.
Don't you see?
Why don't you get a real job instead of spewing vitriol and hatred, you left-wing Limbaugh?
Everybody's taking their dumb juice today.
Come on, Sammy.
Dance, dance, dance.
Ooh.
coital scene with a woman. I'm hoping to add more moves to my repertoire. All I have is the dip and the swirl.
Fine, we can double dip.
Yes, this is a perfect moment.
No.
Wait, what?
You make under $1 million a year. You're scum. You're nothing.
Excuse me? Fuck you, you fucking liberal elite. I think you belong in jail.
Thank you for saying that, Sam. You're a horrible, despicable person.
All right, gonna take a quick break. I want to take a moment to talk to some of the libertarians out there. Take whatever vehicle you want to drive to the library. What you're talking about is jibber jabs.
Classic. I'm feeling more chill already.
Good.
Donald Trump can kiss all of our asses.
Hey, Sam. Hey, Andy. You guys ready to do some evil?
Hitler was such an idiot.
I think I might be a Nazi.
Agree.
No.
Death to America.
Do.
Yes.
Wow.
Wow, that's weird. No way! Unbelievable. This guy's got a really good hook.
Throw our hands up.
Ooh.
Wow.
But Sam, I gotta get off.
No worries. Let's. I want to just flesh this out a little bit. I mean, look, it's a free speech issue. If you don't like me,
hey, shut up.
Thank you for calling into the Majority Report. Sam will be with you shortly.
Hey, let's play a little bit more music because we need to fix things here. Okay?
Cool. RM for it.
All right, folks. 646-257-3920. See you in the fun.
Are you ready?
Who sent us this?
Alpha males are back, boy is back, and the alpha males are back,
just as delicious as you can imagine.
The alpha males are back, boy is back, and the alpha males are back.
Just wanna degrade the white man.
Alpha males are back.
I take all of it in my throat.
Alpha males are back.
Almost says what?
The alpha males are back.
You are a madman!
And the alpha males are back.
I am a total cunt.
Can we bring back DJ Dannerke's song, please?
Yeah, or a couple of them. Just put them in rotation.
DJ Dannerke.
Well, the problem with those is they're like 45 seconds long, so I don't know if they're enough of a break.
That's fucking nonsense.
Hey, folks! Fucking reminder!
I do not have Parkinson's.
And the alpha males are
psych. Fuck them.
Almost says what? What? Almost says what?
Hell of a lot of bank.
Have you tried doing an impression on a college campus?
I think that there's no reason why reasonable people across the divide can't all agree with this. Psych.
And the alpha males are back. And the Africans are black. African. And the alpha males are back. And the Africans are black.
Out there, doesn't a little part of you think that America deserves to be taken over by jihadists? Keep it at 100.
Can't knock the hustle.
Come on!
Fuck them.
Things I do for the bigger game plan.
By the way, it's my birthday! Happy birthday to me, Jew boy!
I have a thought experiment for you.
And the alpha males are back. Africans are black. Alpha males are back. Africans are black.
Budweiser. Blasphemy around here.
I am a total
pussy. Pussy.
Okay, I think now we have it. Do we let Emma into the guys? Got to let Emma into the. Did she not there?
She's let in.
Dude, I don't see her on the thing.
There's two Sam Cedars now.
There we are.
There we go.
Okay. All right.
Can you hear me?
Well, all right. So she's Sam Cedar for the day.
Yeah.
So, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to officially welcome to the show the newest member of the Majority Report family, 10 years in, Emma Vigeland. There we go.
Beautiful. Thank you. I'm so pumped. It's going to be great.
And it was completely an auspicious start. I knocked over the humidifier that was over there. I cussed a little bit in the studio when we had the technical problems. So it's like she was like a, like an initiation rite.
Yeah, I mean, she's getting the picture.
Part of the family now.
That's right. Watching me freak out about tech.
Right. And then just tens of hours of election coverage, potentially.
That's
so
right. That's
baptized by fire.
That's basically, that is basically the story right there. That is
our buffet, yeah.
Exactly. It's, it doesn't get much better than that. All right, so we got a lot of people on the lineup, right?
Tons. Close to 20, I would say. We got a lot of
people. All right. Well, first off, let's now we got the, you heard some of the major places that we're going to be looking for. I'm going to turn on the IMs for folks. You can IM the show via the app at majorityapp.com. I'm anticipating some people calling. It's going to be a little bit, you know, loosey goosey, but those are the counties: Waukesha, Pinellas, Erie, Dubuque, Maricopa. I've got a list of some other ones. We got some counties also from that Cumberland County in North Carolina, Cabarrus County in North Carolina, New Hanover County. I think that was in New Hampshire, right? Where was that? That oh no, Coos County in New Hampshire. New Hanover, I think, was in North Carolina. That was a bellwether, according to Aaron. So, Aaron Kleinman. So we have drained the experts of their knowledge about the counties. That's the way we work around here.
Right. I do want to note that we look like we're looking separate ways, but that is just because of the Zoom.
Oh, all right. Well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to jump out of the Zoom and
yeah,
then get back in.
Well, yeah.
Should I do that, guys?
I don't think that's not going to work because it takes a period of time to reset. So I think if Emma just addresses the camera more today,
all right,
and then we'll try to get the order because Zoom does it by order. You,
what's with Zoom? Why can't you just move around the windows?
I just didn't want people to think Sam and I were unable to look each other in the eye.
We're doing it for COVID reasons.
Right. It's transmitted via eye contact.
Yeah. Project the virus in the opposite direction.
We're speaking different ways. I'm just going to talk to the wall and pretend like I'm looking at Emma.
Right, right. Hey there. But yeah, no, I mean, many counties, many states as such is with election coverage, right? That's what we're going to be looking at. I don't know.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I wasn't really listening when Dave Weigel was on, but what were some of the insights that he had?
Well, it was those. Today? I mean, It was all about those counties that I had just mentioned. He said Waukesha, Pinellas, okay. Erie, Dubuque, Maricopa. And he said if Cunningham, Cal Cunningham is over 6 points in North Carolina, then that looks pretty good.
Right.
Florida, look at Seminole, Pinellas, and Duval County. So I've got these. We're ways off before we get any type of indication of what the results are. And maybe we can figure out some way of like, I don't know, changing our orientation on Zoom. But everybody's saying welcome to Emma.
Thank you guys.
80s guy, Tim from Illinois. Shout out to Emmy. Where's Jamie? She's coming later in the program. Jonah from Michigan. Sam, you got to flip spots with Emma on the Zoom so that you're looking at each other instead of away from each other. Henry Gold. Oh, Henry, still in Detroit. Gary Peters should win, but not sure if the state's going to Biden. Ooh. Jonathan Armstead. Emma, welcome to the show. I first heard of you from Michael Brooks and TMBS and followed your work because of him. I'm sure he'd be happy to have you as part of the family. He loved having you on, Sam. As Sam can attest, I am about baseball, books, or movies, or about politics. So I have three quick questions. What's your favorite baseball team, your favorite book, and your favorite movie?
Oh, man. Okay. I don't have favorite books or movies, probably, because there's so many in that upper echelon. But my favorite baseball team is the Mets. It's a pathetic existence. And that's certainly why I care about them least of my big four sports teams. If you follow me on social media, you'll know I'm a rabid Giants fan. They predictably lost last night, even though they could have won that game. Daniel Jones turned it over twice. So I was like devastated about that last night. But yeah, I care about the Mets, but very distantly for obvious reasons.
Yes. The reasons are pretty obvious.
Right. Although, weirdly, I care about the Knicks more, and the Mets are more successful than the Knicks. But my favorite book, I don't really know. I used to say Wuthering Heights when I was really trying to be super dark and interesting. and I have a soft spot in my heart for longing romances in movies and books, which, you know, makes me such a girl. Favorite movie, I'll probably just go with Sound of Music just because it's nostalgia value, but all that right. Doesn't make me sound cool. That's the opposite of the Wuthering Heights thing. Although, yeah, none of that makes me sound cool. I should have
Sound
some
of
more.
Music gets you some. I think it's sort of, yeah, it's just coming back around.
Look, you know, I grew up with musical theater movies. I now have come to kind of hate that genre, but Sound of Music still has
what
a
about
ton
Singing
of
in the Rain?
I do love Singing in the Rain.
I've watched that. I probably watched that movie more than any other movie that exists, basically because of my daughter.
Fun fact, they used milk instead of rain so that it could be popping more on the screen.
Interesting. I did not know that.
Yes.
My daughter, that was her favorite movie. And then my son's watched it probably two or three times too.
My great uncle by relationship to my cousins wrote that movie.
Really?
No way.
Jeremy Donnan, yeah.
Wow. No, I at my old gig, TUIT, I worked with a very...
Mank.
Ben Mankiewicz, the man. Yeah, yeah.
Huge. So,
old Hollywood.
Old
there.
Hollywood.
Old Hollywood connection there.
I feel like I went to... maybe I didn't. I can't remember now. But all right, let's put that aside. All right, we got to get to the show.
Right.
Who do we got, Brandon, on the line?
We have Matt.
Oh, I was just going to say, because I can see him here, Matthew Film Guy, if you're ready for him.
Yeah, that's the way to do it. You don't just go Matt. Oh, you were saying Matt. Oh, I see what you're saying.
Guys, love
Matt.
Put your camera down just a little bit. Just
so, yeah, we got Matt. We got Matt, and here he is. Here's Matt.
Matthew Film Guy, ladies and gentlemen, maybe... Well, actually, no, you weren't. You actually didn't join the show until after, like, Chris Rosen was exposed. Well, I should have had Chris Rosen on today. Matthew Film Guy?
Hello.
Really? What's going on?
I am celebrating your 10th anniversary.
Look at that. He's got the Legacy Majority Report hat. He's got the Majority Report bandana. I totally forgot about that. It's perfect for COVID. You can find that at the shop.majorityreportradio.com. He's got a I'm Losing It Bro pencil and the sweatshirt. Wow. And you cut your beard. And he's got some CBD. He's got some Sunset Lake CBD. Is that the 3,000?
750. I'm starting small. This is my first time in, but... I've been doing these.
Wow.
And these.
He's got the Farmer's Roast coffee. You got to try some of that.
Oh, yeah, I will.
And this is from, I think this is from Break Room Live Era. This is a Just Coffee mug. So
wow.
I'm celebrating all of the ways that are possible to celebrate. I'm mixing some of the Sunset Lake coffee with my favorite Just Coffee, and I call it Wake and Bake the Dead. So it's got everything going for it.
Wow. Anyway. Well, Matthew Film Guy, do you remember the first time you came on the show?
Yeah, you know, it was post Chris Rosen scandal when he was outed as not a film critic. It was 2011, so it was within.
I need to know this mythology.
Okay, so for folks who don't know, Chris Rosen was a board op at Air America Radio, and then I think he became a producer. I'm not sure. And so when we started the show, people were like, "Sam, there's absolutely you have no cultural knowledge about anything. You're so narrow in your focus, just broadly speaking, in your life." This is people who just knew me outside of the show too said this. And I was like, well, I'll have a film critic on. And at that time, the idea that you could stream movies on the weekend was a big deal. Yeah. And my daughter, I think, was still like 5 or 6. And I was anticipating another child. And so I was like, I never go out to watch a movie. I remember one time I went to go see Skyfall, and that was so disappointing that I was bummed for weeks.
And you ruined it for everybody.
Yep.
Side note.
So I had Chris Rosen come on, and he would give suggestions on movies. And at one point the suggestions were so like unsophisticated. I said, you know, for a movie critic, You're not very.
Yeah, it was like all Will Ferrell's latest vehicle and Adam Sandler movies.
And then he says, this is after like a year. He says, I'm not a movie critic. I'm an entertainment reporter.
Oh.
And I was like,
he's just recycling press releases. That's what he knows.
Yeah, he would just go on junkets. And I was like, what? And then everything turned bad at that point, because then everything became contentious and people started calling in. And I did a whole episode where I think Kyle called in and did an impression of
Kyle's famous impression of him that he didn't realize wasn't actually him.
Yeah. So it got, and then we just expanded out that made that guest like comedy. And then Matthew came in once a week, once a month, maybe to,
keep it totally serious.
Yes.
Right.
Very,
totally cinematic. Good.
If you go to Matthew's, what is it called? Your what?
Letterboxd. Yeah. Letterboxd.com. Yep. You can go follow me there. You can also follow me on Twitter at Langdon Boom. And from there, you can also be taken to my eBay page, which is really happening these days. Well, don't forget.
Will Ferrell movies. Oh, no, that was 40-Year-Old Virgin, where they sell. She has the eBay store. If we're talking about that era of comedy.
Yeah, I think my highest moment.
I wasn't making any point about you, though.
No. I don't know why I thought about that first as an obsolete business, but yeah, no, go.
No, it's not. It's thankfully it's not my main source of income. But I think the highest point of my Majority Report career was when I successfully sold a few bags of that studio air that you're breathing right then and there, signed by Sam. That in a Ziploc bag that went out to some very deserving and extremely dedicated fans of the Majority Report.
What
and then I think, under $20.
Still.
Yeah. And we did the live event where I think I sold my mother's like a makeup box that had like a frog on it. And somebody brought it to the live event to get everybody to autograph. That was also another high point. But you know what, Sam? I also was actually attending that event on election night 2004. Wasn't that at Ars Nova in Midtown?
Yes, it was.
Yep.
It was at Ars Nova. And I went outside. At that time, I wore a bow tie because that was my whole thing at Air America, is I wanted people to get confused about Tucker Carlson and go like, why is that Tucker Carlson? Why is that bow tie guy talking, you know, he turned liberal. That was I figured, because like the bow tie thing was such like a just a way of him just trying to sort of like, you know, brand himself.
Oh yes.
And I appropriated the brand,
And I think it almost worked, but I think he just fooled Glenn Greenwald. That's the only person I think he fooled.
Well, that's funny. But and sometime between my getting on Air America and the election, maybe it was like a month before, he had that thing with Jon Stewart.
Yes, where he called him a dick. Yeah, that was great.
And made fun of him because of the bow tie. So yeah. Ars Nova was right next door to where they taped the deal.
Oh, yeah.
And that's I went right. outside. At that time, I think I was smoking cigarettes. And I went outside to have a cigarette. It's 2004. And I think I went outside to have a cigarette. And Jon Stewart was out there. I'm not sure what he was doing. But he was there. And we were friendly, you know, enough to see each other in a club or something.
Just in the way that you control the media together.
Exactly. And he came up and he must have been taking a break from recording whatever they were doing. And the first thing he said was like, sorry about the tattoo.
Because he knew he did you damage.
Who's this? Hold on.
Somebody Skyping into our Zoom?
Hello? Who's this?
It's Mark Maron. Is Sam there?
Oh, my God.
Oh, my gosh. First off, I hope you know, Mark, that you're stepping all over Matthew Film Guy's segment, which is great. Perfect timing.
Oh, yeah, perfect. He doesn't care. Why should he?
Oh, my God. Listen to that attitude right away. I'm glad you guys have grown so much emotionally. What's the matter,
Matt? Yeah, you're our hero, Mark. Good to hear from you.
Why don't you talk about Cassavetes for 20 minutes? Anyway, how you doing, guys?
We're good, Mark. That is what I was about to get into, but go ahead.
How are you doing?
No, it's all right. I'm sure it'll be riveting. I'm okay. I'm okay, man. I ran out of L.A. I left because I was afraid of my television, and I was afraid to be sitting by myself all day looking at maps and numbers. So I came up to Big Sur, and it's working. It's working. I've done all I can, and I'm just looking at the ocean, and I feel okay in this moment. But if we talk for more than 5 minutes, I'm sure you guys will make me terrified and panicky again. So let's keep this short.
You know what? We hadn't even mentioned anything about that thing that you're thinking about. We're not even talking about that.
Oh, really?
No.
So you've given up, or you just you're trying to pretend like you're not terrified? Which is it?
Well, no, this is the 10-year anniversary of the of this podcast, just coincidentally. And
oh, Jesus, I'm sorry. Happy anniversary, Sam. You know, it's amazing out of the two of us that, you know, you were able to actually, you know, continue to do anything that people would want. And I'm very proud of you that you're able to do that.
I could see how calm Big Sur is making you. We were actually just talking about 2004 and what a crap show that was.
Oh, yeah. Jesus Christ. We've been through a few of these, haven't we?
I mean, know it.
2004, that nightmare, you know, when we were at Air America, and then we did the nightmare again. I can't. You know, dude, I feel this time that I did what I could in terms of trying to. There was a point. It was weird, man, because like you've done the politics the whole time, and you know you're deep in. You know, you're sort of dug in, progressive guy. But you know, for years with WTF, I kind of, you know, focused on the human component of being alive. And then at some point, it was weird. I keep remembering this. Roger Corman came on my show, and his daughter came with him. And when they left, she gave me this weird, you know, picture of this monk, an Austrian monk, I think, who ran a radio show and broadcast against the Nazis. And she was like, my dad wanted you to have this. And I couldn't get it out of my mind. And at some point, I just started to, you know, full on express, you know, my point of view around what was happening in the world and the country and Trump and everything else. And I'm very, you know, I'm happy I did. I feel like I really feel like I spoke my mind and did all I could. And now it's in the hands of the country, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. After 10 years, doing this, with Donald Trump in office and seeing the right go where it went. And frankly, I mean, the Democrats have turned a little bit, have turned to the left from where they were back when, in 2004. But, you know, sometimes you just feel like you're doing color commentary of like the devolution of
end
everything.
Of the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love Devo.
I like the weird thing is just how much people are holding on to this idea of like, no, if we just keep doing what we used to do, even with masks on and in complete fear, maybe everything will magically go back to what it used to be. And it's like, there's no clearer time, like, you know, where people are like, everything has been laid bare. You know, every major television show that operates on a daily basis is just a guy sitting on a couch in his fucking house. And you realize the humanity of everything. And then people are out there shooting these television shows, and it's sort of like after they do a take, they go put a mask on and they sit there terrified and look at their phones. It's like, don't you see that whatever you're doing means nothing? It means nothing, and it's not going to help anybody. So just get out in the street and cry like the rest of the people. I don't know. Maybe I'm being a little extreme.
I am surprised about how much production's going on, frankly, but I don't know. I think we're going to see what happens over the course of the next month or two. But I think if there had been a concerted effort to get rapid testing, we should be able to have rapid tests that cost cost literally like $4 or $5 a test, maybe.
Right. And, when you get it at the drugstore, where you just like almost like a home pregnancy test. You go in, you get a week's worth of the little things, and you poke yourself in the morning, and it's like, okay, it's blue, I can go to work, right?
Yep. I mean, that's basically it. And then you go in, and you got the test. There'll be an app where you get like a little QR code that, you know, you show, and that's, and you know, you put that on your Bumble badge, or you wear it to school, to work, or whatever it is. And it won't go away, but it will be less prominent in our lives. We're just going to have all, you know, these sort of things that we got to do. Like I'm sitting here right now.
I can't believe that they don't have that already. It's because of this fucking administration, I'm sure.
Of course.
I just can't believe they've got to have the technology for that already.
I think there is no doubt in my mind that if the U.S. government threw, I don't know, $100 billion at it, we everybody, honestly, well, we just spent, you know, whatever, a couple trillion, if they threw like 5% of that amount at it, you know, all the other things would be much easier.
Well, that was part of Pelosi's issue with the Mnuchin Trump stimulus bill. I mean, she was basically lying for 90% of it at the end of the stretch, but they didn't have any national testing strategy because they just want to pretend it doesn't exist.
Yep. Mark, that's Emma Viglin. She just joined the show today.
How you doing?
Hi, Emma. You just joined. Does that mean you just started broadcasting regularly with Sam Seder?
Yeah. Well, I'm part of the team now. I'm part of the team. So I'm getting caught up.
I tell you, it took me a long time to recover from that. I hope that it goes okay for you.
Yeah.
Wow. It did.
But look what it led to, Mark. So in some ways,
Nothing like the teeing you up for one of the biggest podcasts in the world.
Well, thank you, Sam. And I always think about you fondly, and I get a lot of laughs. Are you okay?
Are you talking to me?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
Mark, he's not okay.
I'm not great. No.
Yeah.
he's still talking to you and me.
Kids are doing okay.
That's good. That must make you happy.
Yeah. That's the kids are doing okay. They're not going to school, but they're fine. I mean, they're a little slightly feral now, but
yeah. And Matthew, are you?
Yes, Mark. You know, I'm generally copacetic, but you know what? We're all on a knife's edge right now. You know, so what can I say? Knock on wood, I'm as good as can be expected.
And what movies have you enjoyed lately?
Have you ever seen A Woman Under the Influence? It's really good. It's really, really good. No, actually, Mark, a movie I edited played at Sundance this year, and it's coming out on December 4th. It's called Black Bear with Aubrey Plaza. I'm sure you're familiar with her work. So that's the movie I want to hype to you, Black Bear. Check it out.
You edited it?
That's right. Me.
All right, well, maybe we can, I'd like to see it. I'd like to see a screener of it, and then maybe, you know, we could talk about it on the show, maybe.
That sounds great. I'll take a maybe. Yeah,
you're really doing that on air? You're really putting that, you're really setting that up like that on air?
Well, I'm giving it a big maybe. I don't want it to, you know, we'll see how the next few minutes go. So, Matthew.
I'm not going to say anything else. That's it. Thanks.
Now it's just going to come down to how you feel about the movie.
Oh, it's great. Don't worry. Mark will love it.
So
yeah, we can do a Childless Men on Film reunion.
Just got an IM saying that they loved your special on Netflix. I have to concede that I have yet to see that one, but I'm definitely planning on watching it. And also
Take
that the interview with Weigel was really good.
With who?
With Dave Weigel.
Dave Weigel?
Yeah.
Who's that?
That Sam just did.
I just interviewed. I think they had to feel like after they complimented you, they had to compliment me.
Well, that special, honestly, was like, it's kind of creepy. I think it went up like days before quarantine. It really talks all about, you know, what we're going through and, you know, what it would take to bring people together. And there was, it was weirdly prescient, but I don't think, you know, I don't know. The thing is called End Times Fun. So like, it's weird because like having this time to not, you know, to just do the podcast and think about life, I really think I've done everything I need to do. And I think that if things don't go the way we think it might be good to retire and disappear. So that might be the plan.
Where are you planning on disappearing?
Tell us all live.
It like, depends. Like, you know, if it doesn't seem like there, you know, there are hordes of weirdos with guns, you know, corralling up liberals, maybe someplace in the States. But like, it's hard to travel now because we're pig people and nobody wants us.
Right.
So I don't know how long it'll take to shake that. But I think Northern Ireland's nice. And I think... you know, even Vancouver, if I could find a TV gig that that made me live in Vancouver for the rest of my life, that would be fine. Even if it's a Canadian show, I'll do it just to get some sort of citizenship.
I was going to say, picturing you in Northern Ireland, very difficult for me. I mean, can you really picture yourself up there? Like in like a rural, like
I can picture myself for a few days. You know, but then it gets tricky. But then that's when, like, after.
Well, I just assume you were talking about more than like 2 or 3 days.
But that's when I buy my first goat, and then somebody teaches me how to farm goats and sheep, and you know, I sell wool, and it's, you know, there's I have a plan in my mind that involves farming.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah,
sheep herding. It sounds like not so much farming.
Yeah, a little.
Oh, husbandry.
Yeah, but I don't know. Maybe you're right. Yeah, I like my new house where I live, and but maybe it's just a fantasy I have, and I don't really know what I would do the third and fourth day. I really don't know, and it'd be difficult to go down and complain to the locals. You know, they'd be like, "Where'd the Jew come from?" And even
yeah.
If I'm wearing an Irish hat, it's only going to hold up for so long. I'm not going to be able to pass.
Yeah, I have a feeling, too. The complaints aren't going to go over that way. I mean, if you're actually looking for a place like where you're off by yourself, the complaints won't go over well if they don't have a context for it. You know what I mean? Like, it's one thing like, oh, there's Mark Maron again. He's come down. He's complaining because he ran away from America to come be a goat herder. Yeah, it's Mark Maron from WTF. But if it's just like, there's that guy who decided he wanted to herd goats and he's coming to complain to us again.
Yeah.
That's a problem.
Yeah. Well, I mean, sadly, I'd probably be the eighth or ninth guy they've seen try that. Another one. Here's another one.
Here's the next one. Here's the next one.
A few dollars.
sorry, Sam. You got.
I just got muted by my own team.
Wow.
Yeah.
Lucky them. That's so smart.
Well, so what do you plan to do for the rest of the day? You going to go swimming? What's the weather up there like?
It's beautiful. No, I'm not going to swim. I'm going to go on a hike, and I'm going to reflect, think about life, process some feelings, some anger, breathe in the nice air, and sort of just wonder, what happens now. I'm just happy to be out of, somehow or another, the change in environment has shifted my anxiety a bit and my dread a bit. And, I'm just going to try to stay in the present, Sam, and hope for the best.
Well, I mean, that sounds pretty good, Mark.
Thanks.
I mean, that's... Thank you. And I appreciate that you called in to... I don't even know if you knew that it was the anniversary of the show, but thank you.
Of course I did. Happy anniversary. I love you guys. I miss you. Matt, nice to talk to you. Emma, nice to meet you.
Nice
Sam,
to meet you.
It truly is a pleasure. You know I love you, man.
Yes, and I'll talk I love to you too. Soon. All right, we'll talk
love
soon.
Love you too, Mark. Thanks for the
bye.
Maybe.
Bye.
There he is. It's
I'm going on WTF. You heard it. I'm right.
Mm. Mm.
I've already been on it. I think I've been on like 9 times in the early days before he figured out how to actually do the show.
What the format was. Yes, I remember that. I think I did a couple of those early ones too, where I just sort of pretended like I snuck into the studio because he was doing it.
Yeah. Most of them were in the Air America studios.
Early on, they were in Air. Well, I think it's probably okay now.
No, it's statute of limitations. I don't want to risk it.
12 years? 11 years?
Oh, you're right. You're right. It is 12 years. It's over. That's
so, Matthew Film Guy, how are you intending to spend the rest of the day?
Just hanging out here on with you while the people call in and just to listen to you talk to more people. I think that sounds like a great, great idea.
What's your plan B?
Probably just watch it not on the Zoom. Just watch it on YouTube.
Okay. Yeah, maybe.
No, what are you talking about? I got things to do. I'm a very busy independent filmmaker, editor, teacher. By the way, do you know who my latest student is to my senior citizens film?
Yes, yes.
No, do you know who the other new student is?
No, is it my who?
Your mother, Sam.
Oh, is that right?
I've been teaching your mother as well. And what I heard is that your mother loves me. Now, I don't want to repeat rumors, but from what I hear, Sam's mother loves me. And that's
awkward.
That's direct from, I think, your sister, who probably also likes me. I haven't heard exactly if she loves me, but she said your mother loves me. And I love having them. They're great students. Your mom doesn't say a lot, but your sister is definitely contributing wonderful insights into the films that we've been watching. And it's a Zoom film class. It's open to everybody. You can go look on my Twitter for it if you want to join. You can jump in and out at any time. We see a movie a week and then we have a Zoom conversation about it. You may or may not talk to Emma?
What films have you been showing?
Oh man, we've seen like a slew of independent films. Let's see, the most recent one that we watched was Lovely and Amazing by Nicole Hall of Center. We have also watched, I watched Sombra, a kind of a French horror film by Philip Grandjeau. It's kind of a very disturbing film. We watched The Grapes of Wrath. We've watched Fish Tank. We've watched, independent films, art films, international cinema, some old classic Hollywood stuff like Grapes of Wrath. But right. I try to pick out little unknown nuggets that people may not have heard of. And to be honest, that I haven't seen. I like to see films for the first time and discuss them with the class.
All right. Well, Matthew, why don't you give the link if people want to join that class, if they still can. And
go to my Twitter and I'll post it back up on there. It's at commonpointqueens.org. But if you go to my Twitter, I will post it and you can get on it there. It's kind of a long, you go to there. It's like it used to be the Central Queens JCC and now they call themselves Common Point Queens. But I will make sure all that information is there on my Twitter.
All right. Well, Boom. Matthew Film Guy, thank you so much for everything you've contributed to the show.
Absolutely. My pleasure. I really, really, really appreciate it. I love everything that you do. If I wasn't on the show, I would still be a fan. And you guys are the best. And good luck with the rest of the fun 11 twelfths or whatever it is.
All right. Matthew Film Guy, ladies and gentlemen. We are expecting to talk to John from San Antonio. Emma, one of the things that you're going to learn as you spend more time on this program is we have the smartest callers of any show. Really, I think any show. I was going to like confine it to YouTube, but
yeah.
I was going to say anywhere.
Anywhere. Well, I gathered that in my past appearances on the show. So hopefully you all can live up to Sam's lofty expectations or the ones that he's given to me.
John from San Antonio is going to be calling in about 10 minutes. But in the meantime, let's hear, let's play a couple of clips here. One is Tucker Carlson has given his warning as to what will happen if the Democrats take control of the government. Now, first, he argues against statehood for Puerto Rico and D.C. These are not—they're not necessarily similarly situated. I think D.C. should automatically get statehood at this point. I think Puerto Rico should have more of a say in terms of what ends up happening, but the opportunity should be there because it expands democracy. So after he argues against providing more democratic opportunity for people in these two areas, after he argues against abolishing the Electoral College, which is also highly undemocratic, after he argues against expanding the minimum voting age, and legalizing, expanding the franchise, essentially. He then goes on to say that Democrats are going to control with a small cabal.
The president for the next 4 years, that the Electoral College will likely go to the Democrat again. That's what we've seen. And if the Senate also ends up in Democratic hands, plus you have many state houses and state senates, the state legislatures, head in that way, and they have redistricting on the line because this is a, you know, 2020 is a redistricting year.
That's, I mean, right.
Tucker, this is really for all the marbles.
Well, it is, and you, and I'm not sure that that's clear to a lot of voters. I mean, there's certainly a lot of moderate people who are exhausted by the drama of the last 4 years. They blame the president for it. They want something else. Understand. But I don't think a lot of them fully appreciate just how different America will be 4 years from now if we have one-party rule, if there's no balance at all, because our systems could change. I mean, we could see the elimination of the Electoral College, packing the Supreme Court, packing of the Senate. It would be a very easy thing to add Puerto Rico, two new senators. It's possible they could add D.C., two more after that. Possible they could lower the voting age to 16. There's a whole suite of structural changes that are not on the ballot but in effect are, that could make it very difficult, the legalization of 20 million new voters, they could make it very difficult for any other party to wield power in this country. What does that look like? Our system was set up to be divided on purpose so that power didn't vest in too few hands. The trend right now, not just in politics, but in business, is a tiny group of people control everything. And I just fear that's a very volatile way to run a country. Mm-hmm. That's not democracy, actually. It's a violation of the promise of it, and it makes, I don't know. You don't want to tamper with the formula in the way that they're planning to. It makes me nervous.
Last night you wrote in your monologue, but also, you know, you as in the.
Yeah, I love projection like that. I mean, there's a portion of conservative political thought that is always projection, but that seems like you're just relaying exactly what conservatives have done for the past decade or so.
It's also sort of stunning that he is simultaneously talking about how we don't want to limit democracy by having more people participate in the process. We don't want to limit democracy by having more voters. We don't want to limit democracy by having more people represented in the Senate. We don't want to limit democracy by having a situation where it runs contrary to some place like Wisconsin, where you get 54% of the vote, and that garners you 36% of the state Senate. it is sort of impressive where he's basically saying, like, you know, I don't want to gain more weight because then I'll be too light. It's weird that he has just the ability to do that. But of course, what he's talking about, and of course, just the whole notion of like, we don't see Republicans ever play with anything structural, like things like we're not going to provide the opportunity for, I don't know, this president to fill any judicial spots or something to that effect, or we're going to legislate against people of color voting, something like that.
Yeah. And also we saw for 2 years under Obama, this exact scenario that he's now saying is going to happen if Biden gets elected, and nothing happened. Nothing happened at all. In fact, Republicans were emboldened, and we see what we see today. So I find the doomsday scenario kind of speculation amusing.
It's also interesting to me, and I suspect that they've talked about it in other segments. They're not talking about like any of the material plans. Like, it's hard for Tucker to go at this point because, you know, his whole pivot to populism, it's very hard for him to say, like, if we get Democrats, it's going to end up at getting a lot of people health care.
Right. I'm a right wing populist and I don't want these extra million people to vote because I'm a populist for the people. Right.
Exactly. It's pretty stunning. We're expecting John from San Antonio to call in a moment. I just want to remind you, today's program sponsored by SunsetLakeCBD.com. They're doing the whole day, folks. And they are offering, they've got two new, Emma, have you ever tried CBD?
I have tried CBD and other variants of marijuana.
Well, yes. But the CBD thing, I mean, yes. I mean, and Matt is a big smoker of non-CBD hemp.
Yes.
Radical, Matt.
But we were all CBD skeptics around here, to be honest with you. But my experience with this CBD has been pretty amazing. I use it for sleeping. They have tinctures. I've done a little bit of the pre-rolls and I found that pretty relaxing, but also the salve is really great.
I like the one you put under your tongue.
The tincture. Yes.
There you go. That's really good.
Yeah. These are excellent, but they have two new strains apparently. One is the Server. It's 18.9% CBD. It's the most potent hemp flower strain they've ever grown. And a sour special sauce at 16.6% CBD. It's one of the rarest flower strains on the market. And you get 25% off either one of those strains today if you use VOTE25. VOTE25 at SunsetLakeCBD.com. If you use the promo code LEFTISBEST, you still get 10% off all the other products. We'll talk more about Sunset Lake CBD, but they're a farm. It's a dairy farm that provides milk for Ben and Jerry's, and they grow the hemp as like a, just to diversify. They've got all sorts of great regenerative farming practices and $15 minimum wage. The company's predominantly owned by employees. I mean, it's a great situation over there, and the coffee. But they have CBD infused coffee. Gonna try that. Do we have John on the phone yet? I don't think we do.
No.
No? Yes or no? Brendan?
No.
Okay.
No, we're waiting.
All right, let's read some IMs. Underpaid elevator operator. The first thing I ever saw from you was a clip of you complaining about Skyfall a couple of days after seeing it myself. At the time, I remember thinking, what an ass. I thought it was pretty good. I didn't see anything else from you for like a year until I started getting more politically engaged in high school. And now almost a decade later, I'm still a daily listener. Crazy how that happens. Anyway, happy anniversary. Welcome to Emma. Hey, to the rest of the crew, left is best.
There we go. Left is best.
Well, you know where that came from, right?
No.
Okay.
So, again, I need to be caught up on the mythology.
So just after the election of Donald Trump, in Hartford, Connecticut, I think it was, there had been somebody put graffiti up that ostensibly were a bunch of leftists, and they wrote "left is best" in this graffiti, which was quite clearly not leftists doing that. But we adopted the slogan around here, and it is taken off. Here it is: a Trump supporter was arrested for writing super lame graffiti. This is 6 or 7 months later, or when did it happen? Maybe they just caught up with him at that point. It was in June. Yeah.
False flag graffiti.
They put Bernie Sanders 2020 and left is best. Oh, and then they hired for current. Why don't you do? Can you play that video? You can't play that video. That would have been funny. But that's where it comes from. And then we just adopted it.
Yeah. I mean, there's not really much creativity behind that, but the Bernie 2021. I like left is best, though. It's just not the kind of punch you expect with.
There he is.
Yeah, he's riding his bike around. I mean, he's really playing the part. I'm riding my bike around.
Zero emissions.
God, this is what I'm going to do today. I'm going to go out and I'm going to get on my bike and then I'm going to spray paint in the park.
It's like the fake ballot drop-off boxes in California. They accuse the left or Democrats of doing all these horrific actions that they try to prove by doing those actions themselves.
That's right.
Right.
That's right. Voter fraud is rampant. And I know it because I just perpetrated voter fraud.
Right.
I mean, Nixon literally bugged Watergate all the while complaining about LBJ bugging his campaign, which Hoover lied about.
Yeah. No, it's the same. Yeah. Projection is sometimes I think it's overstated, but then story after story demonstrates that projection is a huge part of conservative psyche.
I wonder why that is. I mean, I wonder why.
Primal.
Like, I mean, it's also you also see it in the context of like some of the most rabid homophobes. I mean, this is sort of not terribly profound to say, but, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, I think it was sort of much more clear that some of the most rabid homophobes were projecting their self-loathing for themselves for being gay, I think, outwardly. And I don't know. These days, it's hard to find an example of that. I mean, unless you tune into Steven Crowder, I think. But it's just not.
I mean, Jesse Lee Peterson's likes have been interesting lately, too.
Oh, that's true.
Oh, right.
Did you see his likes?
Yes.
Yeah.
And you have openly self-loathing gay men like Dave Rubin, but.
But I don't think he hates himself for being.
No, I don't. But
gay. I mean, I think he. There's something else.
He uses
going
it
on.
As a shield to be embarrassing.
John from San Antonio.
Yeah, yeah. Good afternoon, Sam. Good afternoon, Emma.
Hello.
John, are you on a speakerphone? You really, I feel like you're rolling in with some swagger today.
This is what I was told to do, so that's what I'm doing.
Oh, you're on the computer. I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. That sounds pretty good. So what's up? What do we got?
Looking pretty good. I mean, I'm just going over my numbers, you know, doing a 1 week screen, a 2 week screen. Things look pretty good. I wasn't sure about the final numbers in Georgia and North Carolina, but I think in the end, I think Biden's going to take both of them. I think Biden's going to win Florida by a little bit larger margin than most forecasters say. I got him winning by 3 points.
Well, you have Biden winning Florida because I've noticed like there's, it sort of feels like the trend is, it's contracting a little bit.
Yeah, that's what people are saying. I mean, I'm seeing the opposite. Like I said, in my week screen, I got him up by 3. In the 2 week, I got him by 2.2.
Can you explain what that means? You say screen. What do you mean?
Well, I mean, polls that the last poll that started polling last Monday and last Tuesday. And so, So I just, you know, historically, you can use 2-week screens and you can get an idea, because usually they're better than I mean, a week screen is better than a 2-week screen historically. But the problem with the 2-week screen is that, you know, the phone polls, which are usually the high quality polls used by the larger major industry people, you know, the Fox News, the ABC poll, New York Times poll, they have a larger period because they have to deal with all the people who actually don't answer the phone. I mean, the people who actually answer their phones and participate in polls is extremely low, and so it takes longer. So what are called supposedly high quality polls actually weren't high, you know, didn't do so well in 2016, and Republicans usually flood the field to make it look closer. And so that's what everybody thought, you know, was happening in 2016. And I think that's one of the reasons why the forecasts were so off. I actually gave them a little bit more credit, and that's why I was a little bit closer actually did better than most top forecasters, though I didn't pick Trump to win. I mean, I still had Clinton winning. But that's what I'm looking for. Just looking at that, you know, looking at Senate races. You know, we've been talking about Senate races for about a year and a half. I just want to reiterate. I mean, I just want to talk about how these races, I mean, most of these people really don't set up with our ideology, you know. So I'm saying, you know, hope they win tonight, but, you know, so we can get the Senate pass something, get a little bit of...
You're talking about the Democrats who are running for Senate in this cycle. It's hard for me to think of one that I'm going to be excited is in the Senate, but for the fact that they're not a Republican. I mean, I'm trying to go over the list in my head. In Georgia, you got Ossoff and Warnock. Who knows whether either one of them will beat the will win in a way that you don't need a runoff.
Cal Cunningham, Sarah Gideon, you know, Jamie Harrison, they're all pretty much centrist, you know, center left.
Who's challenging Joni Ernst? I can't remember her name, but also
Theresa Greenfield.
Yeah. Mark Kelly in Arizona. Not going to be someone that we're excited about.
What do you think about the Danes Bullock race in Montana? Because I have no sense about that because it's Montana. So do you have any thoughts on the data there? Because it's such a small
state. Yeah, I think the last poll, Danes was up by 4. Right. I mean, you do a much larger screen and, you know, he was up in general, like up by 2 points. And so, you know, looking at the slightly margin of error, slightly above margin of error race, I mean, it's going to be hard to peel off the Trump voters. Though Bullock is really popular in Montana, you know, I mean, so it's just, can he pull off enough Trump voters that are going to split their votes? I mean, you know, I don't know. I mean, John Tester obviously is won a couple of races while Montana's been really red. Looking at House seats, looking at progressives, definitely Dana Balter had a good poll from Change Research. I think she's probably in the best situation to actually win a swing district in 24th. I mean, I think she wasn't quite, you know, she's not promoting her progressive agenda as much as she did in 2018, but she still, you know, supports Medicare for all, and I still think she's going to be a good representative.
This is upstate New York, right? This is New York's 24th district.
That's right. So this guy Williams, who's on the Working Families Party line, you know, he was still getting 5% in the polls. I think I talked about that last time. And so, that's going to be interesting to see how many people actually end up voting for him. now that aren't aware. And, you know, even though he doesn't want to be there, the Republicans went to a judge named Stephen Williams and said, you know, they tried to keep him on the ballot. They were successful. Right now, he's in that change poll. He's getting 4%. In other recent polls, you know, he was getting 5%, where Balter was actually tied with John Katko, the Republican. And so I'm hoping people are going to realize that Williams wants Balter to win. Don't vote for him, you know.
Right,
vote for Dana Balter. Kara Eastman just had a couple of good polls, you know, from objective pollsters, which are pretty hard to come by, where she had 1-point leads. Don Bacon had a 3-point lead in another poll, their last, you know, earlier. So, I mean, that race is going to be super tight. I mean, I talked about that race also.
What about
Iowa's
fourth, J.D. Scholten?
Yeah, he's going to have a hard time in that race. I mean, I think that the fact that Steve King, you know, is gone, I think that he was so many people, you know, just they couldn't take his racism. And now that he lost his primary, I think that's going to be a really hard race to win.
It's not like Feenstra is isn't he like almost QAnon, that dude?
Yeah, but I feel like, you know, because King was just such a boogeyman, you know, on name alone, it disadvantages Scholten, right?
Yep.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm looking at this Monmouth poll, and he was only up, he's only up by what, 5 points? And so, I mean, that's not so bad. I mean, I've seen polls earlier where he was up by huge margins, but that's not actually not so bad now that I'm looking at it.
Where else do you think there's going to be, like, because like you said, the Senate, we're not going to have people in the Senate that we're terribly excited about, but in the House, there's the you know, Eastman, Balter would be good. Scholten would be good. Mike Siegel in Texas. What is his chances?
Mike. Well, he's down by 2 in a Democratic poll in the last one in early October. I mean, he's got a lot of momentum, you know, just a lot of people. I mean, I retweet him all the time, you know, because he's close to my area. Obviously got the support from Bernie and support from a lot of different progressives. He has an excellent agenda. So, I mean, it's just so much is going to depend on the vote totals from Travis County and Austin. I mean, they made that district, you know, to be gerrymandered, to make it kind of, you know, a typical crack and pack gerrymander. But now we have so many new people moving into Travis County and Austin. He's also doing really well in Bastrop County, a smaller county outside of Austin. And I'm really hopeful because he's a great candidate. They had two centrists who, you know, fundraised him by, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars, and he beat them both. And so I'm just hoping that, you know, so many people, I think I said this a few weeks ago about Dave Wasserman, and he was putting down Kara Eastman because the differential in Biden's lead and Eastman's lead was so large, and he was saying, you know, don't. The reason this is happening is because she supports Medicare for all.
Right.
And I just, you know, that's ridiculous. You know, we've got to keep running on progressive.
Said
no. Yeah. Wasserman.
Yeah.
Said
it's
that.
Just, it doesn't shock me.
Yeah. And so, you know, I appreciate all the data that he has. He's very, very well researched, but I mean, you know, don't pretend that you're not biased when you make comments like that, because I mean, that is a very biased comment.
So, John, who should we be looking at tonight? Like, who's got the best chance to sort of join the, you know, the squad plus, as it were? Obviously, you know, you're going to the Mondaire Jones and Bowman are going to win their races, and we have Cori Bush, and but who else could we see at least added to sort of on the you know, maybe not necessarily as left as the squad, or maybe close, but who do you think the best chances? I mean, Kara Eastman, Balter, who else?
Well, Mike Siegel, those are the top three. Also, Julie Oliver, also from Texas 25th District. Again, very similar in the sense that it was a crack and pack district. This is covering West Austin and Travis County. It runs all the way up through to Fort Worth. Again, you know, has Bernie support. A lot of people have been, you know, doing Zoom calls with fundraising with Julie Oliver. She's really hardcore on Medicare for All. She's a really great candidate. She's like 2 points down, and we're going to see if we're going to get a break in these districts that have been gerrymandered. I mean, I'm hoping that, you know, six districts will actually flip in Texas. I feel confident that four will, but none of them are super progressive. But, you know, I mean, it's still good to get them in. But also Donna Amon in the 31st district. These are two counties. Williamson County is one of them, just right north of Austin. She's running against, I think it's Carter is the guy from the 31st district. And she was 6 points down. So, I mean, she's right there. Also, we have Audra Denny from Northern California. There was a poll that had her only 4 points down. John Hoadley in Michigan 6, which is Kalamazoo and Benton Harbor. They got a lot of recognition, you know, 7-8 years ago for all the one of the places where they, you know, they took over the government. You know, installed all the what were they called? I know you did a lot of reports on that. I forgot what it's called, but those are the main one. Pat Hackett is another one in Indiana 2nd District who's really good. Dana Ferguson in Michigan's 1st District. I mean, those are you know, districts that Republicans won by, let's say, 8 to 11 points. Beth Dolio in Washington 10th is running against a centrist. She's a really great progressive. She's down by about 10 points in polls. Georgette Gomez in California's 53rd district. Right, well, I mean,
now we're getting on the outliers. All right, well, John, let's do this. What are you going to be looking at? We're going to talk to you later tonight when we get a little bit closer to some results coming in. Tell me the top three things that you're going to be looking at.
Well, I mean, I obviously want progressives to win. I want to see, you know, Democrats to win. I'm actually looking at turnout. You know, I've been touting this huge turnout because of the 2018 race. Just doing some figures. I was talking about how this may be the best turnout since 1908. Wow. So to hit that total, the vote total would have to be 155,510,000. Wow. So we're already at 150. I mean, we're already at over 100 million before people started voting today. Now, a lot
the
of
estimates
people
are like,
wait, we were over 100 million before people started voting today.
I think it was over. I saw it was 99 million plus. So
because the last couple of elections have been around 120, 125 million people. Right.
I saw the estimates were 155 to 160 million.
That's
It's stunning.
Extraordinary.
Yeah. Yep.
Right. I mean,
John, you got a lead with that.
You know, 100.
You got a lead with that, man.
Can I ask you about the Senate races really quickly, rapid fire?
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, because in terms of confidence, I'm confident about Cal Cunningham, correct?
Yeah, I mean, I think his numbers have gone down since the scandal.
Rapid fire, John.
2.7, okay.
Okay, my most confidence probably Hickenlooper, then Gideon, then Cunningham.
Yeah.
Right? Then Kelly?
Right.
In Arizona?
Yeah, I would actually put Kelly above Gideon, but yeah.
I love ranking. It's my favorite thing to do. Okay, so you'd put, all right, but those four you feel pretty confident about.
Right, and that they'll take the Senate. I mean, Doug Jones is probably going to lose, so that's all they really need to do to take the Senate.
Yeah.
Right there.
And then we get into...
I have...
Tillis is going to... Oh, Cal Cunningham.
Right. And then we get into the territory of... I feel like the rest of these could... except Garrett, do you think Gary Peters is going to hold on?
Yeah, the polling recently has really picked up for him. I just think that the COVID's really hurt Trump and John James. Just the outbreak has just been, you know, terrible. I mean, just in the past 2 weeks, the numbers have just improved for Peters. And so I have a lot of confidence that he's going to do real well. I have him up by 8.2 on my two screens.
Okay. And then so that's Michigan for the viewers. And then the rest of it, I don't feel confident about Joni Ernst, because I feel like there was kind of a boomerang effect in Iowa where, you know, it was like, oh, maybe Biden's going to take Iowa. And it looked good, but I don't see Joni Ernst with the incumbency advantage losing there. I don't see Danes losing in Montana. I don't see Lindsey Graham losing, even though there's so much money. I mean, what do you think about that race, Lindsey Graham, Jamie Harrison?
I think that's going to be tough. I mean, it's going to be a tight race, but yeah, I mean, a few weeks ago, I had a lot more
Diane Feinstein. Can you believe it? That, I mean, yeah. This is going to come down to Diane Feinstein.
Because of the hug.
Well, it's not just the hug.
Yeah, well.
But it's the entire hearing that was so botched by the Democrats that it made Lindsey Graham look, you know, like some type of reasonable, that whole thing. You know, they don't show up into those hearings and Lindsey Graham doesn't get this bump. Never mind how big of a bump he got from it, in my mind. But John, we'll talk a little bit later. Okay, bud.
Okay. Can I make one more comment about the Iowa race?
Yep.
You know,
yep.
Greenfield has had leads in the last five polls that just, you know, started on the 29th and up until the 2nd. So I'm feeling that's how I was going to switch it. I had it on Twitter. I was going to go. I wasn't sure about that at last minute, but Greenfield's really done well in recent polls, including a 4-point lead in the Data for Progress poll. So I'm going with her.
Okay. Beautiful. Thanks, John.
Thank you.
We'll talk to you later. We'll be talking to John from San Antonio later in the program, ladies and gentlemen. Let's take a quick phone call. Calling from a 646 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from? This person calls from
this person pranks Chris James too. I'm not sure who it is. I think it might be like a Pepe reference, so it could be a right winger.
Right, that's how you say it. I thought it was Pepe.
I might be mispronouncing it.
Another thing you'll learn, Emma, by working at the Majority Report, if you work here long enough, you won't be able to pronounce certain names correctly.
Yeah, nothing.
Yeah, it's a Bermuda Triangle of pronunciation.
I can't pronounce Kasich. Kasich? I don't know. Kasich? I never know. Never know. Kasich.
830. Who's this? Where are you calling from? 830. Calling from an 830 area code. And you are going. Calling from a 505 area code. Maybe the problem's with me. Check one. Hello. Are you guys there, Matt?
Try another one, Sam.
Yeah, we're here.
Try another call. Maybe I should call back in to the thing.
I mean, it just worked with the frogman, so.
Call from a 505 area code. Who's this? That's weird.
Unless the frog just has it's just an audio loop. And it
call
just
from a 308 area code. There's a problem with the phones. Oh, wait, here we go.
Yeah. Worked for Marin.
Yeah, I think the problem is that earlier your phone system was haphazardly working, so everyone probably has you muted.
Ah.
I, on the other hand, am a tech genius, and yeah.
Kowalski from Nebraska. What's on your mind, Kowalski?
Well, I wanted to welcome your new co-host. I think she's a good addition to your... Are you guys a team or like a squad, or how does that work there?
Crew.
Crew? Okay, that makes sense. So got my votes in, feeling pretty good that Omaha's probably going to go towards Eastman and Biden from what I've been hearing. So let's knock on wood for that. And yeah, that's the other big news for me personally is we're going to be done harvesting today, which means I'll be able to get started on my little program soon.
Fantastic. Now, we'll remind everybody what you're harvesting, Kowalski.
Corn and soybeans.
It's all corn. It's all corn.
You know, I'm the corn king.
My old friend.
God damn it. I got to get out and tend to the combine.
All right.
Jesus. All right. Let's down with fascism. Let's get Biden in there so we can start the real fight.
All right, great. Later. Here we go. Nothing like a farm accident right in the middle of a phone call.
Should power that sucker down.
Yeah, exactly. It's calling from his tractor. They really seem to have lost, the right really seems to have lost the thread here to a certain extent.
Hunter Biden.
Well, yeah, let's talk about this Hunter Biden thing for a second.
Sure.
Cause this is amazing. Will you pull up the image of the story from, what do you call it, from Daily Caller. This is pretty crazy. Hold on, I'm trying to pull it up here. What number is it?
The I Have Cash story?
No, the
I
one
I have it. I can pull it.
Brendan has it. It's amazing. So the Daily Caller, you know, it has a news foundation. Their news foundation is where they actually do some reporting, I guess, theoretically. And here's what we found digging through Hunter Biden's alleged laptop. Now, I don't know why the Daily Caller is calling it alleged, right?
It's allegedly his, but the laptop exists.
Well, the laptop exists. It's just that I've been browbeat so much by folks, you know, from both the right and left who say, like, nobody's denied that it's Hunter Biden's laptop. So why is it allegedly his laptop?
Yeah.
I mean, okay, let's stipulate it is or it isn't. I mean,
they're trying to protect themselves legally from rifling through a normal citizen's
exactly.
laptop.
I mean, supposedly this guy has a ton of laptops. So he leaves all over the country, but it's like he's like Johnny Appleseed of the laptop. But so pull it back up. Pull it back up here. I want to scroll through this. This is pretty awesome. So scroll down. The Daily Caller's News Foundation reports they've been poring over the contents of Hunter Biden's alleged hard drive.
This is journalism.
Yeah. And show how Hunter tried to leverage his father's position for financial gain, which I think like everybody has been saying for... Before the laptop.
Okay.
One email on the drive details how Hunter Biden's leveraging his father's actions as vice president show he was adding value to Burisma. Yeah, no kidding. Joe Biden offered to help Hunter Biden financially on at least four occasions between 2018 and 2019. Text messages on the hard drive show. Wait a second. I thought it was supposed to be the other way around, right? Wasn't the big guy supposed to be getting cut in and kickbacks from all these things? Yet Joe Biden... Now the Daily Caller News Foundation has not fully reviewed more. Yeah, likely story. So there still could be stories on there.
Right.
But the big part is the offers of financial assistance. Okay, Joe Biden offered to help his son financially on numerous occasions between 2018 and March 2019. Whoa. One was in 2019. I mean, this is sort of sad. Before Biden declared his candidacy for president in April of 2019, he got this text message from Hunter Biden. Dad, can you please cash at me $2,000? I'm again overdrawn in my account for bills that can't be left unpaid. I mean.
Yeah, I mean, he's an addict and he needed money. Yeah. Like, this is actually incredibly sad and makes you look bad for trying to make this seem salacious. I can't get over how just making Biden look like a good father was
Hunter
Biden big smoking gun.
Listen to this.
Yeah.
He texted his dad saying, I'll have it all paid back next week, I hope. He texted his father if he was asked if the transfer went through. Okay. Oh, because at one point, because he's finding about the $2,000. He was under significant financial duress when he asked for the assistance. He said he was stuck at a rest stop with no money for gas. In an email to his business partner, Jeff Cooper, while he waited for $50,000 wire for his company. Buddy, do you have a cash app to send me $100 till the wire goes? I have no money for gas. I'm literally stuck at a rest stop on 95 on my way from Boston to DC. That to me sounds like guy's got a real monkey on his back. I mean, that is,
I'm so grossed out by this whole thing. I mean, the whole Burisma thing is newsworthy. And
the thing is, though, but the whole Burisma thing is there in plain sight.
Exactly. And the thing about Biden, and, you know, no fans of Biden here, but he's demonstrably less corrupt than not just Trump, which we know they're all hypocrites for this, but Hillary Clinton, for example. I mean, Biden was never known in D.C., even though he served corporate interests and, was a remarkably centrist and always trying to, you know, thread that needle. He was never known to be a favorite of the donor class. So it doesn't stick because, one, he fashions himself as a working man's guy and regular old Joe from Scranton, but also because it doesn't necessarily match with the reality. So yes, this was a corrupt dealing, but it's small potatoes compared to most corruption in D.C.
It is a systemic corruption, right? This type of nepotism. I mean, frankly, it's more problematic when you have somebody in government. But the trading on dad's or mom's last name happens in every sector, and
I mean, the guy the Daily Caller supports, his son's literally Donald Trump Jr. and has no identity outside of whatever that is.
Right.
I mean, the hypocrisy shaming them, I guess, you know, it's so gratifying, but it's counterproductive because they don't care. But part of why this isn't sticking is because maybe you should care about that. It falls on deaf ears. And also it seems mean-spirited because the thing that overwhelms all this is the fact that the New York Post chose to publish photos of right. Hunter Biden. That's what sticks in people's minds, not the already existing story about Burisma.
Let's here's Brian Kilmeade getting very frustrated on how disciplined the Biden campaign has been. Now, I mean, I think the Biden campaign has been disciplined. I think they're also just sort of like, sometimes it's easier to stay disciplined when you just don't have the energy to do much else. But be that as it may, could prove to be an effective strategy. Here's Kilmeade.
The press have totally protected Joe Biden.
Absolutely.
No one ever talks about his terrible presentation. No one talks about his terrible crowd.
You don't get the full story.
You don't even say, you could pull up in a car and be a big crowd. Number three is you've never investigated his background. You never hear a story about inside the Biden camp, there's tension on X, Y, or Z. You have none of that interesting intrigue from inside camp for the first time ever. You mean everyone gets along and agrees on all the messages?
Am I the only person who's forgotten no drama Obama? There was no intrigue in that campaign. None. Continue. Kilmeade's getting very frustrated. Plan?
My video crashed. Hold on one second.
I mean, the amazing thing is it's almost as if Brian Kilmeade couldn't turn around from where he's sitting and literally look back on millions upon millions of dollars ostensibly expended for the purpose of news gathering. Like the idea that the press hasn't dug into the drug. Where you, I mean, hey, dude, why don't you ask the people who are sitting behind you? Go find out all the drama in the Biden campaign.
You guys got a news division. Realize that?
It is a Fox News. That's the best. That's the thing I really love is just like the frustration that major figures in our news have at what other people are not doing. And apparently they're not doing it either. Keep playing.
On X, Y, or Z. You have none of that interesting intrigue from inside camp for the first time ever. You mean everyone gets along and agrees on all the messages? What went into that thing about him not talking for five straight days? What happened when a series of gaffes yesterday, four major gaffes yet, minor gaffes yesterday, but add up to somebody that is falling apart under his first day of pressure? Why is that not out there? You're going to see these gaffes shortly from yesterday.
They know it's out there, but
no, it's like he cannot conceive of a campaign that is
not built, a crap show,
right? Built on people who aren't entirely self-interested and leaking things to the media so that they can get some sort of leg up and get a better position. I mean, that was the incentive structure built by Donald Trump, and like what you're saying before. I mean, the drama in 2008 was between Hillary and Obama's campaign during the primary when they were at each other's throats, basically. But when it came to the general, I don't, like, he's pretending that didn't exist.
Right. There is simply no internal strife that got reported anyways. Yeah. I don't know. But here's this. I feel like I should be wearing one of those, like, you know, reporters fishing vests type of thing because I got a breaking story. You ready for this? It appears Joe Biden is gaffe prone. Like literally that was like, that's where the whole Uncle Joe meme came from. For 8 years, the one thing that people said is like, he's just a walking gaffe machine. And the press is not reporting on his gaffes. It's an old story. Nobody cares.
Yeah.
Because Donald Trump's a lunatic. All right. Who's on the phone? Who do we got?
Matt Binder.
Matt Binder, old Matt, ladies and gentlemen, old Matt. He's taking his time to get in.
Should have his matching set though.
Yeah, it's right. Check this out, Emma. This is Matt Binder. Look at that.
Hey.
Look at that.
Wow, that's beautiful.
What's up, everyone? Green screen.
Ladies and gentlemen, on the 10-year anniversary of the program, I would like to welcome to the program one of our longtime producers. We have got, you know, maybe a half a dozen or so folks who were here. Matt, when was your tenure on the Majority Report?
I came in March of 2011, and then you found me on Craigslist. And I was there until October of 2015, like mid-October of 2015.
And you were there, Matt was there for the really crappy studio. In fact, you and Michael were the ones who moved, the three of us moved the studio from there to here. The thing I remember about you and Michael in that move was, and I had never seen this before, and I have never seen it since. I had never seen two people who did not know how to operate tape, duct tape. That I thought was pretty impressive.
You didn't pay us to operate duct tape.
I had never seen anything like that before. Michael in particular, making boxes.
What was not understood about the function of duct tape?
I mean, I think it was just me and Michael were just lazy. I mean, it's that simple. We were just very lazy people. We got away with doing the bare minimum wherever we could.
Michael, typical leftist.
Michael is pretty good at sloughing off some work to you, though, on occasion.
On occasion, let's say Michael took on just the hosting gig minus the producer role a lot earlier than it was the official title for him. I mean,
without a doubt. You know, when did we start? We didn't start streaming on YouTube until very late in your tenure, right?
No, YouTube. I don't remember. I remember first we were doing Ustream. If anyone remembers Ustream.
Before that, at one point we'll have Dorsey call in. We started streaming on Justin TV.
We were doing both.
That is
the original Twitch.
That's right.
Right. It was both. But yeah, that was what we were doing then. And then we moved over to YouTube once YouTube started focusing on doing live stream.
Yep.
And yeah, that's the early streaming story of the majority part. That's how early it was. And then the first 12, I don't know if it's you've done any since, but the last 12-hour show was the 2-month anniversary of Occupy in November 2011.
Yep.
That coincided with what? The year anniversary of the show?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That's what it was. In fact, that day, I think, was actually they were clearing out the parks, Zuccotti Park, just coincidentally.
Right. Right. And that day, it was, there was no Michael yet. Michael wasn't there yet. And we were in between second producers. So it was literally just you and me for 12 hours. Yes. We had someone working with us who would come in and get us food and everything and help out when she could, but, she wasn't there the whole time. So if any of you other people in the room, well, over Zoom with Sam, Matt, Brandon, Emma, think this is hard. Imagine spending 12 hours with just this guy.
and on top of it, it was like a room that was, I don't know, maybe like maybe 100 square feet.
Yeah, it was a closet. It was a closet.
And it was dusty. Do you remember when we brought the chairs over to here?
It was, yes, it was... I mean, that dust was actually probably accumulated before I got there, which means you guys set up and immediately the dust just came in and never left.
Wow.
Yeah.
I had no idea we would go this long. Yep.
The entire show, are you talking about my segment here or are you saying bye to me?
No, I can't believe how long this has dragged on.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. 10 years, man. That's insane. Yep. I mean, there's not many 10-year YouTube shows out there, podcasts out there.
Well, I've told this story many times before, but, when Saul was born, I wanted to take paternity leave, I should admit. And so instead of taking it in one chunk, I said like, Matt and Michael will do Mondays. And I'll take those days off. And Matt used to come to me and he always like, I want to interview somebody on like an MRA activist. And I'm like, I have no idea what that means. And he's like, oh, there's this guy like Cernovich, who's this like guerrilla mindset. And I'm like, none of this is politics, dude. It's all like YouTube culture. But I was like, go ahead. And then, of course, like, I don't know, like 3 years later, those guys are taking pictures in the White House. And so that's, I think, when like I got more interested in doing, you know, that sort of culturally downstream or upstream stuff that was so toxic. I wonder if there's an ebb and flow to that, because I don't get the sense that, I mean, do you get the sense, Matt? I mean, because this is your beat, right? Over Mashable on some level. Do you get the sense that like, they're not ascendant at the moment, right? Like there's no coherence to what's going on over there in that world.
It's weird. It's not the same dynamic because there's no like standout new personalities. Like, you know, we're still hearing when it comes to the individuals we hear from, it's still the same old, like, you know, Cernovich, Jack Posobiec. It's all these same names we've been hearing for the past 4 years. No one's really ascended on their own. But with that said, there's an entire new movement that has ascended that to me is much more, it's QAnon. I mean, we are not getting rid of QAnon, no matter what. I think we are in for what, remember the Tea Party, Sam? I think that's going to be QAnon if Biden wins today. It's going to become a more legitimate movement in terms of not just the conspiracy theorists, although they're not going to rid themselves of the conspiracy theorists because that's the, you know, the red meat of QAnon. But these guys are going to just continuously put themselves out there as a movement. And really, I think, you know, Democrats and liberals and even the left will be contending with people who, you know, present themselves as QAnon believers for I don't know how many years, but at least until the next midterm.
Well, we got Marjorie. We got Marjorie Greene, who's going to be in Congress.
But how does that? But wait a second. How does that? What does it look like? What is QAnon without the conspiracy theory? Because from my perspective, the reason why the Tea Party was effective was because there was a narrative that started in mainstream, which is people don't want, government to be expansive in this way. They're mad at the banks. That's what people thought with the Tea Party. They were mad at the banks on some level. There was, and I think a lot of that was constructed, but it started with that construct. And then as, you know, it started getting, you know, people were even a little bit crazier. But how does it go? How does QAnon, I don't know. Pick a Lester Holt on NBC News, talk about the QAnon movement into, you know, Americans' homes every night at 6 p.m. or whenever it is, and with a straight face, and expect people to sort of say like, yeah.
Right. Well, there's sort of two factions, I guess you can call them, that I'm going to break this out into. I mean, there's plenty more. There's, you know, groups who believe JFK Jr. is still alive and still think he's going to announce himself as replacing Pence any minute now on the Republican ticket.
I'm not saying that's not possible, but go ahead.
Right. There's two factions, though. You have a legitimate, in terms of the legitimacy of the Tea Party, in terms of, you know, what you just mentioned with, you know, big government and taxes. And you have Jeffrey Epstein. I mean, the Jeffrey Epstein case has proven to Americans and people all over the world that there is this sort of underground or at least powerful group of people who get away with these sort of things in terms of, you know, sex trafficking and soliciting minors. And they believe that although there is, you know, real child trafficking and sex trafficking, and that's horrible, they believe, obviously, that everyone they don't like is part of it. Everyone who Donald Trump is supposedly against is part of it. So you have that faction, and I think that's a legitimate faction in terms of keeping QAnon in the forefront. But in terms of the mainstream,
but is America really looking to QAnon to deal with sex trafficking? I mean,
no. But this is that's the faction that's going to keep it going for the conservative base, for the far right and the right wing. What you have, though, with the pandemic is, and this happened this year, QAnon was this behind, like, you know, you really have to dig into the internet and know where to look to understand. You have to go into 8chan, which is now 8kun, and you have to go, you know, all these other sites to figure out what's going on in QAnon. But then the pandemic hit, and Facebook and Twitter and TikTok and Instagram became so important for QAnon spread into getting these sort of anti-vaxxers and, you know, Midwestern moms who worry about their children and vaccines and health and you know, child safety. All of a sudden, they're really into the idea that this was a plandemic. And this is all thanks to QAnon, because this is one of those conspiracies that got wrapped up into the broader QAnon conspiracy. So as long as this pandemic is around, which we're seeing now is probably going to be another year or so at least, there's going to be this continued belief that the lockdowns are a Democratic plot to take down Trump. And if Trump loses today, then they worked, which will embolden them even more. You're going to have the anti-vaxxer contingent. They're going to be really emboldened to not accept these vaccines, which means when there is a vaccine, a legitimate vaccine, not one that bolsters Donald Trump's reelection chances, there is going to be an issue with getting people to vaccinate themselves and their children. And so, I mean, how as a mainstream news organization do you not cover this broad movement to not vaccine people with the pandemic?
Well, but they'll cover it, but it's going to be really despairing. Like, I mean, like or disparaging. I mean, I think, like, yeah, I mean, the Tea Party was not disparaged. The Tea Party was taken as a legitimate reaction to the banks, that it was, you know, ostensibly started by that douchebag from CNBC or Fox News or whatever. I can't remember his name now. His name escapes me. But he sat on the Chicago Stock Exchange floor and basically had this sort of like cri de coeur about people bailing out mortgage owners. You know, there was sort of some racist overtones to it, frankly. It's like people going in and getting into their loans that they don't deserve and this and that. And that's what it was, Rick Santelli. And that's what launched the Tea Party. And that was treated by the news media with a, certainly from my perspective, more respect than it deserved. But it was treated with a lot of respect by the news media. In fact, at one point, Rachel Maddow, there was an extended period of time where they were, you know, people were wearing tea bags on their head.
That, yeah.
You remember that? And like, she was talking about tea bags and this and that. And it became problematic that she had done that at one point, like that as Tea Party gained more respect. But I mean, the idea of QAnon, they've got to do something different. It has to I mean, QAnon can maybe be the driver, but it has to package itself in something different.
Oh, absolutely. It's not going to be out there as QAnon. I mean, all you need is someone like Marjorie Taylor Greene to become a U.S. representative. And there you go. You have a legitimate person in office who's going to announce some of these things. I mean, she's not out there saying she's QAnon anymore. Like her and the 80 some odd other QAnon candidates have mostly, not all of them, but there's most of them have backed off of it in some way or another. I mean, you don't like, there's going to be, I mean, face it. She's going to, Marjorie Taylor Greene is a sure thing. She's going to be in office. Yep. And when she goes to work in January, she's going to be sitting next to some of these people who for the past year or so, probably more depending on where she found QAnon, has been saying that these very people she's sitting next to are secretly trafficking children and taking part in satanic rituals. I mean,
do you think she's going to just say that about Democrats, or do you think she's going to say it about Republicans too?
Oh, they believe it's Republicans too, but they're not, they don't focus on that part of it because obviously, you know, it's going to hurt them. They would never do that. But I think there's, I mean, I agree with what you're saying for the most part, but also it's not going to, in terms of the, it has to transcend into something else, evolve into something else. But I mean, it's also 10-year difference here. We're talking about in that 10 years, I mean, half the country probably doesn't give a shit what Lester Holt thinks anymore, you know, so he doesn't take QAnon seriously. I mean, 10 right. years ago, maybe right. them taking the Tea Party not seriously would have meant something. But if CNN doesn't take the new Republican cause up as a serious movement, do you think, you know, 90% of those people are going to care? I don't think
so. Well, I'm not concerned about them caring. What I'm concerned more about is Democratic lawmakers caring. I mean, that's my point, is that and maybe this is an old paradigm, you know, that I have, and that maybe this is somewhat problematic, but the old paradigm was crazy ass stuff from the fringe on the right would get laundered through Fox, would get disseminated through talk radio. It would get laundered through, what's his face? He's not even relevant anymore, but the dude with the big
Glenn
website.
Beck?
No, the dude with the big website. Brendan, what's that
Alex
guy?
Jones.
No.
Drudge.
What?
Drudge.
Drudge.
Yeah, they would launder it through Judge. If you talked 15 years ago, if you talked to a producer of ABC News, I guarantee you the first thing they would do every morning was to look at Drudge.
Drudge, yeah.
They would look for their links at Drudge. And then this stuff would seep into the mainstream media. And then Democratic lawmakers were terrified and they would listen to it. Now there's a lot more savvy today, right? Like, you know.
Do you think part of this too, like the disconnect that you're talking about the fact that, you know, they cared about this back when Drudge was posting all these things? Like, a lot of this originates from really online culture, kind of what you were talking about before. So there's also just this lack of understanding or inability to connect with QAnon and and where it comes from and how it's perpetuated.
Well, I mean, I think in a good way, you know, Nancy Pelosi is not going to understand, like, it's not going to feel any pressure from QAnon. And similarly, AOC is like, I don't give a about, you know, like, she's not going to. I mean, but so the old paradigm, though, was that this thing seeped in, and then Democratic lawmakers are like, I got to worry about the Tea Party. They just came to my town hall and, you know, in the middle of talking about healthcare, shut the whole town hall down. I mean, that was a big, important dynamic at the time. Now,
it's not going
to QAnon shows up at the town hall when they're talking about the Green New Deal and says, you're a pedophile. Like, I think that makes it easier for them to walk away and go, like, these people are lunatics, but I'm still going to vote for, you know, whatever it is, expanded public option, or, you know, like in some way, the fact that it's this crazy is you know, takes them out of the realm of, like, influencing mainstream non-Republican lawmakers.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, but I think it could just, I think it could spread a little bit more aggressively online because of what that culture breeds of constant skepticism of government and power. So that's the unhealthy route it could go, if you agree with me, Matt.
Yeah, I totally agree. We're really not looking at the same dynamic in terms of, you know, the Tea Party put the pressure on Democrats as well. QAnon's not going to pressure the Democrats. Democrats aren't going to look towards QAnon for anything. But I mean, the QAnon is going to really take over the Republican Party like the Tea Party did, in my estimation. I mean, you brought up how, you know, they you know, scream pedophile at whoever, but I think they've successfully used that word in a way that's really warded people off away from fighting back against certain things in the online culture. I mean, that word has become such an easy word to just end conversation and basically declare yourself the winner because everyone's so scared of, God forbid, their name showing up next to the word pedo on Twitter or on Facebook because some idiot who believes in, you know, in satanic child trafficking rings, lobbed it at them. Okay. I mean, I've seen
swatting almost on some level.
Well, it's
I mean, look at the
Hunter Biden things too. Yeah, go ahead.
Look at the whole cultural blowback that happened with the friggin' Netflix movie Cuties. Anyone who came out and said that movie was a good movie, a coming of age film that did what it intended to do, or not, if you didn't like it or whatever. But that's not what the discussion wasn't about, the merits of the movie. The discussion was basically, if you saw the movie, you're a pedophile. And the QAnon people were some of the loudest voices in that. And I literally saw some prominent online leftists back off that whole cultural discussion because they were afraid. And they came out and said this to me, that they were afraid to get involved because they didn't want to be called a pedophile. I mean,
yeah, true. And Ted Cruz was involved in that too. Like, the GOP signed up with that.
Right. And they said that Netflix should be taken to court and someone should be put in prison. And they, I mean, I know this means nothing, but it got so far that in Texas, Netflix was indicted or something over the movie. I mean, it's not going to go anywhere, obviously, but that's how far it got. I mean, that's just the beginning. Like, no, I'm not bringing this up because to talk about this Netflix movie on November 3rd, 2020.
I don't know. I got deja vu. I feel like this is, on one hand, I feel like almost the same way that you and I had this conversation like 6 or 7 years ago, where I'm like, I'm sorry, dude. I just don't get, like, what? He's a pickup artist? I don't get it. I don't get it. What? How is this going to impact politics? Gamer what?
Right.
You're talking about there's a controversy involving ethics in game journalism? I'm sorry. I don't see it. And it reminds me of that. And it reminds me that, like, I just didn't see it. I didn't see how I was going to mutate in it. So I'm sort of like at once both skeptical and also thinking, like, I have no idea what I'm talking about.
Right. I mean, I don't know right now what's going to come of it. I don't know if
there's this massive energy that's out there that is already touching upon politics. And we see it in the context of, like, I don't know, half a dozen candidates who, some varying degree or another, are built out of QAnon. We see it on Facebook. It has a, it, I mean, there's just a, there's just a, there's a disturbance in the force, and it's out there somewhere.
I mean, before Facebook cracked down on QAnon, and they've actually probably done a better job now. I mean, it's late, but I guess better late than never. They've really cracked down on it more than any other social platform. But before they did that, there was an internal Facebook study that leaked where they looked at just how prominent QAnon was on its platform. I'm assuming this helped them come up with their policy that banned QAnon outright later on. But they found that across the QAnon groups and pages on their platform, there were 3 million of their users involved in these groups. So we're not talking about this little tiny, like, you know, conspiracy anymore that it was, you know, in 2017, 2018, even 2019. There was a hockey stick, if you're looking at a graph, in terms of how big QAnon got during the pandemic. People were home, unemployed. They go online because they don't have anything to do. They're bored. They fall into these conspiracy theories. QAnon was the big conspiracy at the time. Because the way QAnon set up, you could pretty much wrap any conspiracy into it to keep those conspiracies going. The anti-vaxxers, the anti-maskers, the plandemic, the COVID hoaxers, they all became QAnoners. That whole thing altogether shot up. And here you have millions and millions of people who believe this utter nonsense. And you're going to have some of them in Congress come next year.
Well, Matt, I'm glad we had this conversation. It's sort of like it is it tracks nicely on the central thesis of your producership here. And of course, you're also joining us every Thursday in the fun half these days.
That's right. Always fun in the fun half with Matt, Jamie, Matt, Brendan, and Emma. Will you be joining us in the fun half Thursdays? Or
she might. We still got to work that out.
We're very fluid.
There's not
in our planning.
There's not planning. I've spent most of the time on the plastic sheathing in here. That's been the. And
Sam and I are currently looking at each other through shower curtains.
So
You actually in the same room right now? By the way, Emma. I got to say, I can no longer hear your first name. For the past 7 months, I've been locked in a home with my two children, one and five-year-olds, and they do nothing but watch The Wiggles. And I don't know if you're familiar with The Wiggles, but there is...
I am not familiar with The Wiggles, but is my namesake involved?
The most popular character in The Wiggles is a girl named Emma. And they literally are going, you know, she is now the main character of the show. There are songs about her, E-M-M-A, Emma. And whenever I hear the name Emma, it's all I could think of. And when I saw you,
it sounds like my show to just further buoy my narcissism.
The Wiggles have been around
online and on camera. What were you saying?
The Wiggles have been around for like decades now, but they're finally like breaking into the super mainstream because they decided to add.
Much like QAnon.
Right. Much like QAnon, the Wiggles. So they added their first woman Wiggle to the team and she blows up and they're making millions and millions of dollars off of her alone, it seems. So Emma, you share a name with a very famous children's actor.
I heard she's a pedophile, but I don't know.
Matt Binder. Thanks, buddy. We'll see you soon. We'll check in with you. I gotta follow.
Subscribe youtube.com/Matt Binder. There's like 13,000 people watching on your feed right now. I'd be missing a huge opportunity if I didn't say
go check it out.
youtube.com/Matt Binder. And when this show ends at like midnight or after, I'm going to attempt. That's why I got my Monster Energy. I'm already preparing. I'm going to go live after you guys are all done. youtube.com/Matt Binder.
More junk food than like we just replaced Matt Binder almost like that was one of the things he had to drink. He had to eat all sorts of junk food just to fill in for Matt Binder.
All right,
Matt. Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Take care.
I should tell you folks right now that this is still coffee.
Canned cold brew there?
Yeah. This I went through my actually brewed coffee. And had this in reserve just in case, But I start to open it and I saw your side look, Emma.
No, well, I was like, I can't do it that early. I can't drink that early.
It's only three. Seriously?
Yeah, it's only three.
Like, pop a brew. Because...
And also I feel like I stretch my breakfast into lunch. Getting hungry. I'm getting there.
I have apples over there. I should probably take this time to announce that I have a new favorite apple. Longtime listeners of this program know that I have deep and abiding interest in apples, and that I am a grower of apples. I have a new favorite apple. I've also learned some disturbing things about one of my top three or four apples.
What's the disturbing fact about your apple?
Honeycrisp. Oh. Involves a lot of pesticides.
I like Honeycrisp too.
When you're not getting it organic, it's a very pesticide requiring apple, particularly in New York. I'm only talking about New York apples. I don't indulge in this whole thing about.
What are your thoughts on Pink Ladies?
Pink Ladies are good. They're a very competent apple. Longtime listeners of the show will also know that I was able to tell them a year or two before it happened where Galas became the new Delicious apples. You'll know that Delicious for years and years was like the apple that was sold in like bodegas, or it was always like the default apple. Horrible apple.
Yeah. Like the pure red one. Kinda.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. When you got to say it's delicious, it's probably because it's not.
Right.
And they replaced those with the Gala, which is also a very competent apple. It's fine.
I laughed for a good, 15 seconds over here about the term competent apple.
It does its job. It shows up. It's not a horrific like the Delicious, but it's also not that impressive. Right. So the apple, my new favorite apple, ladies and gentlemen, it has a skin that is a little bit tougher than a Honeycrisp. It has the crispness of a Honeycrisp. It's not quite as sweet, but it's still pretty sweet. But it also has more of like a heritage feel, like with an Ida Red, maybe. It is a Snapdragon.
What?
Yep.
Okay.
Snapdragon apple.
I've never heard of such a thing.
Those are good.
Two or three. Excuse me?
They're good.
Should I try it and debut it on the show?
Yeah, maybe later in the program you can grab one of those.
Right.
I got three of them. I brought them in. But Snapdragon, I'm telling you folks, that's the apple. I'm also like, Arkansas Black, but that's a survivalist apple because that keeps like almost for the entire year.
Now I'm blanking on it, the green ones. Shoot.
Please.
A Granny Smith?
Granny Smith?
No.
Oh, come on. Oh, I love Granny Smith.
Seriously?
I like sour and bitter tasting things.
Then you want a pristine apple, which is a green one. It's an early apple in July. It tastes like that sour apple candy that you get.
Ooh, that might by default be my favorite.
Yep. There you go. Who do we have next on the program, Brendan? Is there somebody in waiting? We should, right?
Matt?
Kelly.
Oh, Kelly's here. Classic Kelly is with us.
Hey, Kelly.
Classic move by Kelly to not actually have her camera on or the audio. There she is, folks. Producer from, when was it?
2015 to 2017.
Yes, the 2015 to 17 era. Wait, oh, so it was into the Trump era, right?
So it was before, so it was like cool and funny, and then it was nightmare hell.
Right.
Not the show purely, but life.
Life in general, yes.
Yeah, it was very funny, and then it was very not funny at all.
Right. That was basically it. That was a rough, night in 2016, election night.
Yeah. I left, but I forgot that I left. I think I left after like Florida was called, And then I just had to walk around, but I might have like blacked out or something because I totally thought that I had no reaction. And you told me later, you're like, no, you left. You like ran out of the studio. And I was like, oh, right. I totally freaked out.
Yeah, it got a little bit dramatic that night. That was tricky, without a doubt.
Yeah. Are you a crier, Kelly? Because I definitely cried. I'm a big
crier. I hyperventilate.
Ah,
how are you, Emma?
I'm doing good. How are you, Kelly?
I'm good. I'm so glad that you are.
Kelly and I were coworkers at TYT as well, so it's a big circular, or it's more of a triangle with you, me, Sam. We're all connected.
Well, everything is kind of a circular thing in this world, but in the progressive media world.
I was saying,
I wasn't like saying, you know, time is a flat circle like Matthew McConaughey.
Kelly, we were just talking to old Matt, and
who had
set up our YouTube streaming. But you really were responsible for our YouTube streaming as a sort of as a viable element of the business, as it were. And today, of course, we are not. We don't have more subscribers than David Pakman, but I don't blame you for that in any way.
Not entirely.
That's a big source of wonder for me.
Shots fired.
It is because I am now, you know, as you know, doing what I started doing for you on YouTube for a bunch of other progressive channels. And, you know, David Batman's
great. Are you saying that that there are bots involved?
No, I'm not necessarily saying that, but I'm saying it's a lot of growth very quickly at a time when no one else grew. I mean, it was like almost like there was a purge time during that time. Whatever, I don't know.
Whoa,
be sus.
Yeah, I guess. This is a shots fired again. Wow, this is very controversial.
The word is controversial.
What did I say?
Controversial.
Hard S. Controversial.
He'll never. I mean, you were saying this earlier. If you stay on the show long enough, you won't be able to pronounce anything.
Right.
It's very endearing, and it's very
controversial.
Endearing. Controversial. Shoal.
All right.
Shoal.
I'm in.
You know,
we want to do it.
Tomato.
Kelly, I'm glad you dropped by to say hi and celebrate our 10-year anniversary.
That's crazy.
It is pretty nuts. It is pretty nuts. In fact, what really is crazy to me is that we've been in this office for 6 years, I guess, going on our seventh year. It's pretty crazy. For some reason, I was so traumatized by the first office that I felt like that was the majority of the years, but this is actually double.
Yeah. You know, what's crazy to me is that, you know, things being a circle, like we were just saying, you know, Dorsey introduced me to you, and then I said, you know, later on recently, hey, Sam's been wanting to do a morning show. You should produce it. And now he's all up in the mix.
Well, and Dorsey, of course, was the first producer of the show.
Yeah, on Air America.
No.
No. Well,
No, Dorsey never were. I never worked with Dorsey directly at Air America.
Okay.
He was the first person who launched the Majority Report. In fact, I was, you know, I don't want to steal any of his thunder when he calls in, but this show would not exist. And when Kyle comes in, I don't want to steal his thunder either, but the show would not exist at all if Kyle didn't, if Kyle was not a human being. If he wasn't around, I mean, he could have been a human being, but if it wasn't for Kyle, the show wouldn't exist. And then Dorsey, I was like, I saw Dorsey. I'm like, I'm thinking about doing this thing. I don't know, man. Cause like, I got no money and I've got like some equipment that I can sort of like, I hoarded from Air America that might work. And he's like, I'll do it. And I'm like, look, I don't know how much I can pay. He's like, I'll do it. I'm like, well, no, but I mean, like, I'm going to do this every day. He's like, yeah, I know, I'll do it.
And then I worked with him immediately, or maybe concurrent. Well,
at one point, he got a real job. And I was like, I understand. You have to go.
Well, no, we worked together twice. But the first one was a fake job. We had a fake job together. And I think he was working with you, which was real. And then we're working together now, actually, on another project.
Well, we like to bring people together. That's the important thing. All right. Well, Kelly, thanks for coming by. Thank you for all your help over the years. Of course, you're still working with us these days, but you set this show off on a great trajectory. And it's too bad we're wrapping it up after this week. So thank you.
All right. Well, I am very grateful to have met you. And
unless
to
it's a memorial, let's get my, come on.
No, I just think that everyone is so great that's involved with the show. And, you know, Matt, you know, he doesn't answer my emails sometimes, but Matt, I'm really glad to have met you. And
that the emails, oh, Matt's email broke. So
yeah, it's been weird lately.
It broke. And I just think Emma is so wonderful. And I'm just so glad to be a part of it.
Thanks so
much,
Kelly.
All right, well, thanks so much, Kelly.
Okay, thank you, guys.
All right. Now, welcome to the program. Another guy has actually worked briefly as a producer on the show as well. At one point, Brendan went off to try and go to Hollywood to get discovered. And so he left the show for a brief period of time. And they, you know, it's like classic story about Hollywood. You go out there, you don't get the attention that you want. Brendan was the fresh face for a couple of days and then it all just sort of dried up. But in the meantime, Mike from PA helped out with the daily research. And of course, then he went on to steal my background. What are you doing?
Can you guys hear me?
What is going on here? Everybody takes the backdrop.
I've taken the backdrop too. Oh yeah. I'm stealing the backdrop. Sam, how are you? I didn't hear you there for a second.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mike from TV, Mike
from PA.
But on, you could see him on Twitch TV /central_committee.
Yes, that's right.
Why an underscore?
Because underscores are very important to my brand. All right. It's not authentic if you have a name without an underscore. That's like an elite thing. I don't know. I mean, like, look at all the people with underscores in their names. I see you. I represent you. I am with you.
So dude, almost 4 years ago to the day, maybe it was
I think it was a day after Election Day, yep. 2016.
You called into the program. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it was the first time you called in.
It wasn't. I had called in a couple of times saying how worried I was about Trump in Pennsylvania.
And you said, but I do remember you saying that you had called in a couple of days before saying that you were concerned about this, that the you were working on the Get Out the Vote, and you mm-hmm. said we were knocking on doors and like something like 25% of the doors we were knocking on were Trump voters. And when you're a week out from an election, your get out the vote efforts, you should be hitting like, I don't know, 15/16 of the people that you knock on the door should be your voters, right? Maybe 31/32 of the people, not 3/4, because that means that your numbers are off. And like, and they hadn't done proper field.
No.
And we heard so much about working with Google and Schmidt and their data analysis, and they had modeled who their voters were, et cetera, et cetera. Jeez, you really got it going over there.
Oh, I know. I'm so sorry about that. Oh, and, let me hide this stuff. Anyway, go on, Sam.
And that was a big problem in Pennsylvania. What's it look like this year?
So it's funny because we thought that the Hillary Clinton field organization was odd in their decision was to focus on voter registration, whereas the Biden's decision is to focus on no field at all. And basically, because they were worried about the perception that it would be unsafe and you would spread COVID. So they've kind of gone completely doubled down on that strategy. And most of the field being done now is by like Bernie Sanders aligned progressive groups like Pennsylvania Stands Up, Lancaster Stands Up. Those are the groups, and like individual down ballot campaigns are the ones that are really carrying the burden in a lot of these swing states, which is very scary.
That matches with Dave Weigel's reporting. I don't know if you guys talked about this earlier, Sam, but like, Ilhan Omar and other progressives around the country are doing door knocking. So it's not just in Pennsylvania. This is a national thing where the Biden campaign's just like, we're hiding until the election. The numbers look good for us. And so progressive groups are the ones usually, per usual, getting their hands dirty.
But that to me,
they're also not doing the voter registration that they did in 2016, which is a big problem.
We talked about those numbers as well. They're, Republicans out-registered, or at least, I don't know. I've heard two different stories. One is that they definitely out-registered, but that some percentage of those were people who would vote Republican and now have simply changed their registration to reflect that, as opposed to new voters who had never voted before. That was Aaron Kleiman's story. I mean,
that's a story that I don't know that it's true. I don't think we will know until election day, right?
Like, well, it's election day, dude.
Yeah. And that's not what you want to hear, but I'm just saying that's the truth, is we don't know if that's actually the case. And actually, I think it's wrong, because Pennsylvania does publish, they differentiate between party switchers and new registrants in the official like report. So I don't know where they're getting that. So I think they're just wrong.
What are
on
the
that.
Numbers in Pennsylvania for new Republican registrations?
I think I can find. I don't have it. Hold on, let me take a look at this new registration. I have this somewhere. Give me one second here.
All right. Well, nevertheless, give me your sense of like what's happening. Like, I'm not convinced. Let me put it this way. I'm glad that there's progressive groups that are going out there and building these organizations, because, you know, they don't necessarily die on the vine. Right. I mean, building these organizations over time and through different through different cycles is good from a progressive standpoint. It may not be good from a we don't want Donald Trump to win standpoint, but I guess we'll see. But what is your, I mean, give me your sense. Do you have with that said, do you have the same concerns about Pennsylvania that you did last time?
I think the environment, like the voting environment, as far as the support, is better for Biden than it was for Hillary. I think Trump has hardened some of those people that voted for Obama twice, but voted for him. I think some of them are permanently in the Trump camp now. But there's been an additional like effort. There are new voters. It's more complicated, but I do think that he's in better position to win if the votes are all counted.
Right.
This is a huge problem that we could get into, I hope, soon. But
well, I mean, that's the issue, right? I mean, like, my understanding is the Republicans have sequestered any of the ballots that come in. It doesn't matter when they're postmarked, because we're only talking about ballots that have been postmarked today or earlier. Any ballots that come in after 8:30 p.m. tonight will be sequestered. Mm-hmm. And they're going to go back to the Supreme Court and attempt to basically say, don't count those ballots. Now, here's the question that I have for you. Do you think it's possible there are election officials in specific counties that may just say, we're not going to do that?
Well, that's not a hypothetical. We know that to be happening right now in Lancaster County. A Republican commissioner just said that he will not be counting the votes for the votes. So basically there was a Supreme Court decision, Pennsylvania Supreme Court decision, which was multifaceted. They also made a humongous blunder, which I hope we could get into, because there's two aspects to the counting problem. The first is the one you're talking about. So let me dispense with that. Basically, a Lancaster County Republican commissioner said he will not count the ballots that arrive after Election Day until he gets a, quote, directive from the Supreme Court. Now, there's already a decision from the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, which was upheld provisionally by the U.S. Supreme Court, saying that you should count the ballots received that are postmarked by Election Day, received by November 6th. However, they are going to segregate those ballots. They're going to keep track of the ballots that were received after Election Day, 8:30.
Right.
And those could possibly be tossed.
Right. That's what I just said. But is it possible there are election officials who will actually just count those, that they get ballots that come in at 8:30 and they do not sequester those ballots? Because once those ballots are mixed in, that's Johnny ball game. You can't
That's true. I mean, they would be held to contempt of court because there's like a standing order to sequester. So, I mean, if they wanted to risk,
I don't know.
Own,
I mean, what
their
I mean,
own freedom.
I'm a county official. I'm going like, I got the state Supreme Court that says I can count those ballots.
But they say it has to be sequestered, if I remember correctly.
The state Supreme Court says this?
Yeah, I think they did.
Actually. Or did it? Was
no,
it
no, I think it was the Supreme Court. Hold on. Let me get the.
I mean, because here's my point is that, like, you know, if the Supreme Court of the United States is going to say we're not beholden to the state, what the state court says, that if I'm an election official, I'm like, well, I don't, the federal court has not told me to sequester them. So if I go by the federal court, I can just count these. Once they, okay, and even if they count them, okay, you hold me in contempt. Mm-hmm. How much is that going to be? $150?
And what's the tension between the fact that the attorney general, right, who's making a lot of these decisions in Pennsylvania is a Democrat. And the state government in Pennsylvania is still GOP controlled, right?
So the governor is Governor Wolf, and the Secretary of State in Pennsylvania is appointed by the governor. So that's a Democrat, and the attorney general.
Sorry, I misspoke. The Secretary of State.
They're all like all the statewide offices are held by Dems, but there's extreme gerrymandering at the state legislative level, which is another wrinkle that we could talk about.
Well, yeah, I want to get to that in a minute because that was fixed. The congressional districts were fixed by the state Supreme Court, but somebody, for whatever reason, I've never fully grasped why we haven't seen that same suit on a statewide level. But my question is, I guess, is that I understand that order is to sequester there, but once it's not sequestered, then there is no remedy. And then those votes be counted. And then it seems to me what could potentially happen is I'm the local county elections official in a Democratic county, let's say. And ballots come in. They come in after 8:30 p.m. And I don't even know what that means. Comes in after 8:30 p.m., right? Like the mail, I presume, is dropped off at one time. Maybe there's been actually an order by a federal court saying that you got to go to extreme measures to get ballots there today. And so maybe the local post office is like shuttling mail over every couple hours. But I don't know why 8:30 p.m. like my mail comes at 10 a.m. And if it's not here at 10 a.m., I got to wait till tomorrow at 10 a.m. But let's say a ballot comes in at 9. Mm-hmm. And I'm a local election official, Democratic
Loki-Oki.
It's a Democratic county, let's say, and I count that ballot, and then I count another one. Well, that seems to me like, okay, which ballot is it? I don't know. I didn't record two votes for Biden after 8:30 p.m. I didn't sequester them. I just know, this is my tally. And so at that point, it seems to me that like the whole state is now compelled to count every ballot that came in until 9 p.m. And if the guy does, you know, keeps doing it or she keeps doing it, like then it's just over, because how do you remedy that? You can go and send this person to contempt the court. But I'll tell you something, if I'm an elected official in blankety blank county in Pennsylvania, I mean, like, I'm going to count them. Because all of a sudden I have all the power. I can like, how else do you remedy that? The only way to remedy it is to keep counting for the next 3 days. Any ballots that come in for the next 3 days.
I think what you're highlighting is the insanity of trying to cancel ballots that are postmarked by election day from a registered voter that have followed all the rules.
Have been legally cast.
That's right.
Once that ballot is in the mail, the voter has no control over when it's recorded. So the idea that it's somehow the fault of the voter, nonsensical, obviously.
I mean, there has to be at some point a practical deadline, right? Like, you know,
we know what that is. Deadline.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
So, you know, because sometimes things get lost in the mail and, you know, you can't have a ballot showing up in January and then say, oh, we should count this. There has to be some sort of practical deadline, but in
when
the pandemic.
Vote for the electors? I mean, we know that there's a certification date where every state has this needs to be certified by X date.
So Pennsylvania's is November 23rd is the hard deadline. That's when the counties have to certify their official results to the county, to the state, is November 23rd. And I honestly would not, if I'm being pessimistic, I would not be surprised if we are a week from today not done in Pennsylvania. I think Friday is the absolute earliest that Pennsylvania's votes will be complete as far as the count goes. And that's if everything goes according.
That's assuming there isn't going to be like 12 different lawsuits that are, right, you know, both on a federal and a state. I mean, this is basically why I got to say, like, Florida, come on.
We need a national standard for voting. We need to, you know, take it out of the hands of the states and partisan politics. Because Pennsylvania, like, the governor wanted to alter the election law to accommodate the pandemic, and the Republicans in the state legislature, the gerrymandered state legislature, would not agree to do so. So they allowed this kind of shit show to take place, where we have a lot of serious problems. I'm going to send, do you want to talk about the naked ballots as well?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Tell us about the naked ballots.
So I'm sending a letter to Brendan.
To complain?
Yes, to complain, of course. But it's from Philadelphia commissioners, and they talk about naked ballots. Now, what is a naked ballot? A naked ballot, basically in Pennsylvania, when you mail in your ballot, you have an outer envelope. That's where the voter, you know, declaration, where you sign it, where, you know, all the information about who that vote is from is at. And then there's another envelope, a privacy envelope. So when you take your ballot, you fill out your ballot, you're supposed to put it inside this privacy envelope, then take that privacy envelope, put it into a large, that outer envelope.
Right.
In the primary, there were, in Philadelphia alone, 11,000 people did not use the privacy envelope. They just put their ballot directly into the outer envelope.
Because people are not born with the innate understanding that you need to have two envelopes for something. Right.
The purpose of the second ballot, the second envelope, is privacy. Because when the election official takes apart that that ballot, they could technically see who your name and see who you voted for.
Right.
You know, and then
the idea is that you're signing the manila envelope on the outside.
Right.
Certifying that you are the voter, et cetera, et cetera. And then the inside, there's usually a white envelope that has your ballot, but nobody, when they open that, they're not going to associate your name with it.
Right. They put that into a different pile.
Right.
So they don't, so your secrecy is assured, but they also make sure that every registered, every ballot coming in is associated with a registered voter. Then they check off your name. So you can't have a second vote come in because your vote has already been recorded. And that's a way of preventing like fraud. And the problem here is
just the idea though. I just want people to contemplate this. The idea that people are like, if you see how I voted, I want my vote invalidated.
Right.
Nonsensical. Because the problem with right. you, let's say Mike from PA, seeing my vote, it's like, God, Sam, you fraud. You voted for Donald Trump. How could you do that?
Right.
But the vote's invalidated. Phew. Thank goodness. So that when Mike says, like, you voted for Donald Trump, say, like, no, I didn't. The vote was invalidated. No, it doesn't make any sense. It's like, at the very least, at that point, you want your vote to count because they already know that how you voted. But the idea is that somehow, like, there's no, the idea that that's a remedy for that is ridiculous.
Also, to be honest, if you've ever been into a Philadelphia counting location, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of ballots. They are not doing them one by one by hand. These are loaded into machines. No one sees. Like, they verify it, and then those verified envelopes are put into a machine that opens them and extracts the ballot. This is not done by hand because it would be, frankly, almost impossible, or you'd have to have an army of people doing it. So they use machines to do that. So there is no possibility of this actually happening where I could associate you with a ballot.
So you're saying that it's impossible that in the where they're counting all these ballots, let's say in Philadelphia or something, that somebody's not going like, hey, guys, everybody keep your eyes open for Sam Seder's ballot because we want to see how that dude's voting because I get a feeling about
it. Yes, I'm saying that's impossible.
Okay. All right. Well,
I'm saying that's impossible. And not only that, the numbers here are staggering. And this is what I'm the most scared of. Is in Philadelphia in the primary, they had 11,000 naked ballots and they counted them. In the Supreme Court decision, Pennsylvania Supreme Court decision, they said in the future not to count them. And they estimate, in the letter I gave you, they estimate that there will be 30,000 naked ballots in Philadelphia and 100,000 naked ballots statewide. And the reason why this is a concern is because Democrats are voting by mail at a higher proportion than Republicans, meaning that mail-in ballots are more likely to be a Democratic ballot. And it's not that Democrats make more mistakes than Democrat or Republican voters. They forget this at the same rate. This is a common mistake that people make, and it has no connection with your partisanship. It's just the form of the vote is more likely to be Democratic. Therefore, any way, any like technicality that invalidates mail-in ballots at a higher rate than other ballots will disproportionately hurt Democratic candidates. And in Pennsylvania, it was 44,000 votes, I think, in 2016. That was the margin. So right there, if they invalidate 100,000 ballots from naked ballot problems statewide, that is probably, could be a significant margin and could flip the state.
I mean, people got to remember Pennsylvania, 40,000 ballots, 40,000 votes in 2016. I mean,
that's a big problem.
So a big Mike, problem. Let's get to the good stories. You're so negative.
Oh, like, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be negative.
What about the things that might make us feel better?
Well, good things in Pennsylvania. Oh, well, I mean, you know, it looks like
gonna be a lot of fracking.
Well, don't even get me started on that. But good things. Congressional candidates, Susan Wild and Matt Cartwright, these are two of the swing districts in Pennsylvania, key for, you know, holding the House in the long term, are both look like they're going to win on a platform of supporting Medicare for all.
Sweet.
So, you know, kind of put that in your memory banks of people who say that Medicare for all is toxic in a swing district. Doesn't seem to be so here in Pennsylvania. Pat Toomey's retiring, you know, 2022 open seat. Medicare for all supporter John Fetterman, lieutenant governor right now, is probably going to be the chosen candidate.
Oh, really?
So yeah, looking pretty good for progressives in PA statewide. Yeah. You know, we might see.
You don't think Shapiro's going to run?
Shapiro's going to run for governor because Tom Wolf is term limited out for 2022. So Shapiro looks to be running for governor. That's what I'm hearing in the grapevine. So Shapiro is a little bit more of a standard Dem. So that's good news, right?
Yeah, those are good news. And I guess, I guess we're going to have a sense of what's happening with Philadelphia in terms of like some type of trajectory as to where the state is headed for future elections. Or maybe this is just ends up being Pennsylvania ends up being like, you know, the Ohio of yesteryear.
I feel like there's a real tension in politics in Pennsylvania, especially in the Rust Belt in general. Like a lot of what seems to be successful has been more progressive candidates, more left candidates, economically especially. You know, people like John Fetterman, who I think is one of those people that everyone should keep an eye on, maybe a model, like, you know, a big 6'6", bald, tattooed, muscly guy running on a progressive platform. I think that's probably the future in Pennsylvania for the Democrats.
Well, you know, what people forget about Toomey is that Toomey was the Tea Party sort of like anti-establishment guy. He ran like two cycles in a row trying to knock off Specter and Arlen Specter. And I think he may have tried to run in this cycle before that as well. And he was a Club for Growth guy. And I don't even know, we never even hear those words anymore. But that was the anti-establishment energy at that time. And so there is I think, in American politics, and I think this is happening in Pennsylvania, I think it happens in other places, there is a, on one hand, like a set of policies, and then that people subscribe to or not. And then there's like a sort of disposition where mm-hmm. people are perceived as the anti-establishment character, even exactly. if it is, even if they actually support the mechanism in which the establishment maintains power, right?
Trump,
for instance. And so there are some states, I think, that are more inclined to that than others. And so if there is a sort of an attitudinal quality to a candidate that is dovetailed with policies that are consistent with that narrative, and they can be consistent from that narrative from the right and the left, because, you know, anti-establishment just means I'm out of power. Yeah. And sometimes the old boss is the same as the new boss.
Right.
But if you can, package it in that way, it'll be interesting to see.
Well, one thing about Toomey is he did represent a policy break from Arlen Specter. Like, Arlen Specter was one of those old school, quote, moderate Republicans. And Pat Toomey really was an extreme far-right corporate,
yep,
from Wall Street candidate. And when he was elected, he became the mainstream of the Republican Party. There was an ideological shift that
yep.
took place, and he became normal.
Yes.
The new normal.
Toomey first ran, I remember we were like, this guy's a complete marginal lunatic. And now he's just sort of like center of the Republican Party.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, eventually he was on the one gun control bill that they brought up after Sandy Hook, because, you know, he was facing a tough re-election in 2016, and he was kind of allowed to launder himself. He got a lot of Bloomberg money pumped into Pennsylvania in 2016, I think $7 million to help the Republicans in Pennsylvania, which was probably decisive for Trump winning. And then Bloomberg became a Democrat, and he got multiple speaking times in the DNC at the same time he was supporting a Republican in a key seat that the Debs, you know, ended up losing by a point or two on 2016. So, but hey, centrists can literally support Republicans, sort of like Carrie Eastman out in Nebraska. I don't know if you've been talking about that race as much.
Yeah, we've touched on it a little bit. You know, we'll see. That's a big race. Because
that's the race I'm watching, that Nebraska electoral college vote and that representative seat. Huge for, you know, preventing a tie if that happens, and, you know, seeing another progressive running in a swing seat, it's important to support them.
Well, Mike from PA, I hope that if you end up calling in tomorrow, I know you got your own show and it's a little bit, hope that when you call in tomorrow, you're like, well, we won't hear about Pennsylvania for another couple of days, but you know, it's redundant at this point.
That's my hope. Please, Lord, do not count on us. Please don't, or else it's going to be very scary.
I think I feel like I've told you many times, please do not refer to me as Lord.
Well, you know, Sam, you have a similar background as the Lord. So
where did that background come from?
I don't know. Where did it come from?
The background that you got there.
Oh, no. Well, see, I wanted to show people how you steal the panels. Now, my panels have red blotches in them. And as you know, Sam, red is traditionally the color of democratic socialism, the labor movement, and the left. And I find it curious that the color red was taken out of the David Pakman panel setup and remains an important integral part of your panels. And so I wanted to match you as a part of the left and have those, the red, included in my version of democratic politics.
It's unbelievable. I should have trademarked these freaking IKEA panels when I had the chance. I mean, I didn't have the chance.
Yeah, David Pakman kind of like, is like the Majority Report without the red. Yeah.
Interesting. Interesting. Boy, Pakman is really drawing a lot of attention today.
Yeah.
Mike from PA, folks can check out twitch.tv/central, of course, _.
Very important.
Because if you go to Central Committee, what happens if you just go to Central Committee and there's no
I don't know. It's probably some defunct channel. I could just take their name, to be honest with you, but I haven't. And I, in my chat right now, I'm posting the Medicare for All co-sponsors, because some people in the chat denied that Matt Cartwright and Susan Wild were on Medicare for All for some reason. I just wanted to fact check you, provide you my source. Medicare for All wins in swing districts. Don't let anyone tell you any different.
There you go, folks.
All right.
Mike from PA, appreciate it.
See you, bud.
All right. Folks, I'm going to step away for a moment, but Emma's going to hold down the fort. Coming up in about 20 minutes, Janine Garofalo is going to join us. So
I'll be.
Yeah,
we may want to shift to the new YouTube at this moment.
So we're also going to shift to a new YouTube channel because we can only have 4 hours of streaming. So where's that link? Do we have the link?
Yeah, the link is in the current, what you're watching now, in the description. So you can click over and that will start. I mean, I can do it right now if we're ready to do it now.
Yeah, why don't you do it? Emma, you hold down the fort. I'm going to go downstairs. I think there's a food basket for us downstairs. I got a call from the front desk and I'm going to go to the bathroom.
Okay.
There we go. All right. We'll be right back.
All right.
All right.